Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I'll remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. Mark Griffin and Stephanie Callaghan are both joining us remotely today. And the first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? We're agreed. Thanks. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the committee's annual review of NPF 4, National Planning Framework 4, from two panels of witnesses. And on our first panel, we're joined by Katrina Hill, who's the chair of the Highlands Islands Architectural Association, Royal Incorporation of Architects in Scotland, Ilse McFarlane, who's the director of Built Environment Forum Scotland, Craig McLaren, who's the National Planning Improvement Champion at the Improvement Service, and Jenny Munro, who's the Policy and Practice Officer at Royal Town Planning Institute. And I welcome our witnesses this morning. Before I move on to questions, I wanted to remind members and those participating in today's session that there are current active legal proceedings concerning the interpretation of NPF 4 policies and the interaction between these policies and existing local plans. Under the Parliament Standing Orders, a member may not, in proceedings of the Parliament, refer to any matter in relation to which legal proceedings are active, except to the extent permitted by the presiding officer. And whilst we do not wish to discussion and debate to be unduly restricted today, I would ask members and witnesses to avoid referencing specific matters that are currently before the court. We're now going to turn to questions, and we will try to direct our questions to specific witnesses where possible to start, but if you want to come in on a question, please indicate this to the clerks or myself. And there's no need for you to turn your microphones on and off. We'll do that for you. One less thing to think about. And I'd like to begin with a couple of questions. One of the things that we hear about, and I'll name somebody, Ailsa, I'll direct it to you first, so you know it's coming your way. So one of the things that we hear about are calls for the Scottish Government to establish a hierarchy of NPF 4 policy priorities, and the idea of this would be to help decision makers and developers. Would you support the development of such a hierarchy, and if so, why?
Good morning, and thank you very much. We have long suggested that perhaps some sort of hierarchy, maybe perhaps more prioritisation of policies rather than necessarily a full hierarchy, may be helpful. And we very much appreciate that, that planning is both an art and a science, and that flexibility is very important to be built into the system. But I think the wider concern is perhaps about planning being asked to do a lot of the heavy lifting in relation to a wide array of additional policies, be that community wealth building, wellbeing, net zero, just transition, and that there isn't full policy alignment across a wider suite of policies across across government, and that is perhaps where the greater issue comes in, that that planning is expected to address all of these topics simultaneously. And whilst we know that planning obviously contributes well towards these things, it seems that the heavy lifting is left very much to planning rather than other areas.
Thanks. Does anyone else want to come in on that? Craig?
Yeah, I think we're about a moment in time which we need to think about in terms of how this could be played out. As you know, the way in which the NPF draft is just now, the Annex 1, I think it is, talks about how you need to read all policies and take into account all the different policies across the document. I think it's important to think about, as we're taking forward the local development plans, which will be a component part of the process once they're in place. We're building an evidence base there just now. The evidence reports are going to be a really, really important aspect of that. We've seen the first one of those emerge from Fife. It's about 400 pages, but it's got a wealth of information within it. I think those evidence reports will be really important in providing the context for future decision-making, and that will therefore lead to you thinking about which policies are more appropriate than others. So the hierarchy may come through what you're doing in terms of what the context is, what the evidence that you have in front of you is as well. So I think there's something to think about how important that evidence is, because, as we know, planning decisions are very much based on often quite a lot of evidence, to be honest with you. But that evidence isn't always there yet. There wasn't an evidence base for the NPF as such, other than the process that went through. So I think at that local level, that can make a difference and therefore maybe focus some attention on how decision makers make their decisions.
Okay, so just to clarify that, you're saying that by actually doing it, a natural hierarchy will emerge?
Not necessarily at a national level, but for each individual planning authority, there are certain circumstances they're working in. Their evidence report will tell them what the situation is, what the issues are, what the challenges are, what the opportunities are. And from there, they can then look at what of those policies in the NPF and in their own LDP are most appropriately used in that particular case.
OK, and in a way that makes sense. If I think about 32 different local authorities and the planning, the parks authorities, there is quite a difference if you think about a central belt planning authority versus an island grouping. Would anyone else like to come in? Jenny?
Hi, yes, I'd just like to, well, firstly, yeah, very much agree with what Ailsa and Craig have commented on. The other point to note probably is looking at it from that hierarchy at a national level. I mean, this is something that our members are certainly interested in, and when I've had discussions with them, there is a need, an obvious need for a steer on what they should be prioritising. However, when I've asked them, well, what should that look like? Nobody's been able to give me a definitive answer on that, and I think that's quite telling. And I think this maybe stems from the fact that when you look at MPF4 as a document, it's very textual. It's not. It's got very few spatial elements to it. And certainly when you look at the national planning policies, the way that you could apply these across Scotland is certainly not uniform. So I think it does require that local consideration. You know, you've got some parts of Scotland with carbon-rich soils, but with also increased demand for housing. You've got others, you know, with degraded areas of peatland and varying potentials for restoration. So it's not uniform across the board. And I think perhaps the point that Craig was saying about the evidence reports is true, to give that sense of hierarchy, but at that local level, I think, is what's required potentially. Although very aware that we're not at the stage where we have all of the evidence reports. So what do we do in the meantime, I think, is an important question.
Certainly, this is the first review that we're doing after a bit over a year of it coming into play, and there's quite a lot of elements that need to get bedded in, and also, yes, changing of kind of approaches in planning. And in kind of terms of, we touched upon some of the policies there you were touching on, Jenny. I'd be interested to understand if at this point we've got any evidence that the MPF4 policies on climate change and biodiversity are having an impact on decision making and planning authorities. Are you seeing that?
I think there is certainly some evidence that that is the case. All anecdotal, because we haven't, of course, done any research specific to this question. But there is certainly evidence that we can see from conversations with our members about impacts on onshore wind. And also some of our members saying that they have noticed a levelling up of how biodiversity, for example, is being handled in proposals. So those considerations coming at a much earlier stage of the application process rather than as an afterthought. So that's all certainly quite positive. But we're also hearing from our members that this focus on climate change and biodiversity is perhaps not necessarily filtering through to everybody. And I'm not just talking about planners, but those that sit alongside planners. So thinking, for example, about statutory consultees, we've heard that they're perhaps, some of them, not all, are perhaps not prioritising climate change in their deliberation of proposals. I mean, to a degree, this could in large part be a resourcing issue and a capacity issue for those statutory consultees, but also potentially an issue of mindset as well. So obviously they have their own areas of interest that they're focused on. And so they're perhaps not necessarily thinking about how these things should be weighed up against this focus on climate change and the nature crisis, etc.
Do you have any examples there of statutory consultees? Can you just so we understand who that might be?
Yeah, again, this is all very much anecdotal from the conversations I've had with our members. So if you were looking for specific examples, that's certainly something I could reach out to our members for and come back to you on that, if that would be helpful.
Useful, certainly, yeah. Craig, Elsa, Katrina, any thoughts on the biodiversity and what you're hearing, the climate change biodiversity piece? Are we seeing that have more impact? Craig?
I'll go first, if you wish. Certainly, I think there's been a growing awareness of the need to look at approaches which try to make sure we tackle climate change, and particularly for biodiversity, as Jenny said. I think the whole issue of biodiversity is really moved up the agenda for people. You can certainly see that. So I think that's all good. I do, however, think there are still some issues with the understanding and the application of that. I think particularly around the biodiversity side of things, there has been quite a lot of work done by Scottish Government. There's been guidance published on it as well. There's Nature Scott are currently out for consultation just now on the metric around how you get a sort of net gain in biodiversity. To be honest, I don't know enough about it, but I do know that other people say this is quite a shift for them. And there's a need to try and support people to be able to apply that in actual practice, which is the hard bit. So they're up for it, they get it, but just some of the tools to do the job and the skills to the job are something we need to invest in.
I mean, I think in Jenny's response there, what I was picking up was something that I'm experiencing in the region with some local authorities where decisions might be made at a planning level, but other departments have done things differently. We still have a culture of, right, I think we're in May month or whatever it is, where we're not actually supposed to be mowing anything because that allows the habitat for a lot of insects and other wildlife that we share this patch of the earth with. But what I'm understanding is that there's still a practice where the other departments will get out there and cut things down. And there's also, I think, maybe a mindset shift that needs to take place in the general public in terms of what we think is tidy and clean and neat and versus what we really start to understand what needs to look, how things are going to look if we're going to be a biodiverse and climate supportive country. Any other thoughts, Ailsa?
Yes, more in relation to decisions around individual homeowners and climate change. Again, anecdotal, but we've been seeing some evidence that sort of more positive decisions around net zero and the use of our individual homes have been taken with better protections for non-designated heritage in particular. I'm considering decisions around windows. This has been something where there's been a number of positive decisions that have been able to be made specifically because of NPF4. However, I have also had mentioned to me that Permitted Development Right 3 is undermining that quite substantially, and that the balance between those policies has been really quite difficult at a local and individual level. But with that,
just so that people understand who maybe not, what can you say a bit more about that permitted development right that's undermining?
It's in relation to the types of windows that can be put into conservation areas specifically, and Permitted Development Right 3 is very much sort of a, it's not quite a blanket yes to change, but it's very much a case of materials like UPVC and that sort of thing can be considered as long as they sort of match in style. Whereas the planners that I'm dealing with are very much looking at evidence that say that isn't the best solution in the long run for energy and net zero gains, as well as for material uses and for homeowner comfort, as well as obviously the heritage impacts. And just the final point I'd make on that was that I still think NPF4 is lacking to recognise that homes are part of infrastructure, as was mentioned within the Infrastructure Committee report originally. And I think that would help us to use our existing built environment more effectively, particularly in relation to climate change.
you just say a bit more about that idea of homes as infrastructure?
The Infrastructure Committee report back in, I'm afraid I cannot remember what year it was, but there's a strong recommendation within that that homes are considered as an infrastructure for Scotland, as well as all of the other kinds of infrastructure that I think we'd be more aware of from a planning perspective, and that reusing what we have and ensuring that it is maintained and reused was also a recommendation within the infrastructure report as to how we consider our existing built environment more broadly, and that that isn't recognised within NPF4. Infrastructure is obviously well recognised, but homes as part of that isn't considered within NPF4.
Do you think that if homes were recognised as infrastructure, then, and the whole idea of like we need to reuse what we have, that we would then have a stronger retrofitting agenda?
I think that that would be part of a strong drive towards a better retrofitting agenda, because there would be a better understanding of what we already have as well as the changes that we can make for the future.
Thanks for that. Katrina, anything to add?
I would add on the retrofitting agenda that we are strongly supportive of adaptive reuse of existing buildings. That's something that we would like to see a lot more of, but it needs to be supported by funding. And one point that's been raised by our members almost universally is there needs to be a review of VAT on refurbishing existing buildings, particularly listed buildings, where there's the added challenges.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey now with some questions.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, everybody. Just briefly, Ailsa, back to that point about the windows and conservation area status. We will be looking at this, I think, later on in the committee session, but did you say that the conservation area are excluded from that relaxation in PDRs?
No. They are very much included. Within PDR3, and that's where some of the concerns arise. There's obviously the people I talked to are very supportive of there being appropriate changes that support net zero and support protections for climate change, but the most recent PDR3 is enabling changes which people believe are not necessarily the best for the existing conservation areas, nor the best choices for the environment in the long term.
Okay, thanks for that. just in sort of broader terms, I mean, we're a year into NPF4, really. It's the early days, really, in a long journey. But are you picking up so far, in terms of developers' proposals, are they beginning to change to reflect the principles behind NPF4? Would you say, are you seeing any evidence of that? Craig, you mentioned the Fife document, but that's really a guidance document, is it, local development planning? But what about developers themselves? Are you getting any sense that proposals are beginning to change to align up with the principles behind NPF4? Katrina?
Yeah, we are definitely seeing a move to more inclusion of biodiversity, active travel, places for people, lots and lots of positive stuff, but it is tempered with a real, almost a dread and a fear that the planning process is slowing down. Developers are very worried when it comes to putting planning applications in that they're going to take longer than they used to. We're seeing that's possibly down to a lack of resource within planning authorities, but we're certainly there's a move to provide much more material at the point of the planning application. That's all positive, that's all good, but it comes at additional cost, additional expense, and it puts another burden on the whole process of development.
Okay. Any other experiences that the colleagues could share in terms of developers' proposals beginning to line up or not even? Craig?
Yeah, I think, as Katrina said, there's a general feeling that this is something which has to be done now from the development sector, and I think they're taking it much more seriously than they perhaps did in the past. Where we are down the road with that, I'm not entirely sure, to be honest with you. And again, I feel as if I've said this 10 times already as part of this session, but because we're at a certain stage and where we are with the NPF, we're not quite sure how that's going to come out in the end, to be honest with you. I think given the case which was mentioned earlier, I think there's been a bit of a reticence to put lots of new planning applications in to see what the lay of the land is. So I think it's going to be something we're going to have to watch and see as time goes on. But I do know some of the big bodies are trying to encourage this as much as they possibly can. I do think things like 20-minute neighbourhoods, which have been seen as an important aspect of the NPF. I think there are things which I think there's still a bit of struggling with from the developer side, but I do think it's something we really have to try and make sure we attain and we put in place as much as possible. And I see a lot of planning authorities trying to figure out how best they can do that. We had guidance published, was it last week, on that, which I think will help with that process as well. But I think the thing about that, if I'm focusing on the 20-minute neighbourhood side of it, is that there's two bits to that for me. One is the way in which we plan our places, the way in which we design our places to try and make sure that they're accessible for all the different services which you need and you can use. But the other thing is how we deliver our services. And that's where I think there's probably a slightly bigger issue, because the direction of travel, particularly in terms of public sector and public service provision, is to bring things together rather than to actually put them into smaller pieces and put them out in the middle of the community. And I think we have to address that. So it's probably a public sector issue and a private sector issue, to be honest with you, and one we're still, as I say, still on that journey with.
Yeah, I was kind of just about to come to that. Sorry, you've kind of introduced this quite new. I'll try and stay out of areas that other colleagues are going to come in on and so on. But just on that issue about, you know, 20-minute neighbourhoods in terms of planning developer proposals, are you hearing that the developers are having difficulty defining and articulating what they mean and what they plan in order to line up with NPF4? Or are you hearing that the local authorities may have a different interpretation of what is meant by that? And is that one of the reasons, Katrina, that things are slowing down a little? Or do you think?
No, I think the professional bodies understand 20-minute neighbourhoods very well and are able to steer their developers through the process. So I think there is a good understanding of how to do it, but it needs to be backed by funding, and it needs to be backed by an ability to deliver it. So we're seeing challenges for some of our some of the case studies that have been presented to me show difficulties in actually making the budget work with all of the desires that people need to include within their development.
Could you maybe try and give us a wee example of that? I mean, like, are developers saying, yeah, we can comply with this overarching requirement, but it needs extra resource and funding that? What are they saying exactly?
For instance, a project that's being funded through the Levelling Up Fund has got a very clear budget. It's being funded from a government development source, and it needs to meet the criteria of this framework, which was brought in February. But the process for developing this project started some 4 years ago. So did the budget. So now to find that extra funding to deliver those extra things, which actually we all want, is challenging. And there are many developers that are in the same situation where they're now looking for extra ways to bring in more funding into a project.
And are you seeing that the expectation on the part of the developers is that these additional components, let's call them, should be funded differently and separately by somebody else, but not them? And they still include them in the proposal?
Depending on the nature of the project. So, for instance, I'm doing a lot of community housing development where the development is actually being undertaken by the community. So largely these are amateurs who are not involved in capital works on a day-to-day basis. And Scottish Government really support this nature of the communities developing projects. But they're challenged when asked to add in that extra active travel path. I mean, that path is a great idea, but it might be a project killer in actually trying to fund it. So I think you'll probably hear in the next panel a lot more about this, about delivering rural housing and rural projects.
Okay. Any other comments from other... Craig?
Yeah, one point to add to what Katrina said. I think the nature of 20-minute neighbourhoods is it just brings in more complexity. That's the nature of it. I think we all agree the ambitions of 20-minute neighbourhoods are a good thing. But it's more complex because it's not just putting one particular use somewhere on a site. It's about bringing together lots of different uses, which might have lots of different funders, might have different people who can do it from public, private, voluntary sectors as well. So that complexity is something we need to try and deal with and get, in some ways, get used to, because it's always going to be there. But it also means it's not as simple as maybe things were in the past. But the things we had in the past weren't probably what we wanted. Yes, but the point is, it's going to be more complex, but the benefits will be more worthwhile.
Comments on the 20-minute neighbourhood and the current shape of developers' proposals coming in? Jenny, Ailsa, anything that you can... Okay. OK, thanks very much for that just now. I know colleagues want to come back in on some of these areas. Thank you, Convener.
Yeah, I'm going to come back in on the 20-minute neighbourhood because obviously we're talking about the new builds, but we've got a whole lot of existing, 80% of Scotland's housing stock exists. How do we transform them into 20-minute neighbourhoods? That's something I've been trying to get my head around. Any thoughts on your side of that? Craig?
I would say not specifically, and I would say it is helpful that the NPFO does have policies built in that help to support how we change our existing places, particularly around the provisions of services. But I would say that the complexity only grows when you're considering the existing built environment and where you put those services. I would also say that we possibly need even more information about what we have and where we have it to be able to best plan those options for communities, particularly at times of transition where local government provision may be changing. There may be a number of sites that may come up for potential community ownership within any community, be that urban or rural. And what the shape of those places look like should obviously involve community decision making and the best options for those places. But that also involves sometimes taking a longer term view than perhaps communities are looking at when faced with, you know, a building that suddenly they're perhaps asked to take on and save and use for the community, for example. But actually, will that be the right space in the right place for a very sort of sustainable future for that community? So I think that's an area where we maybe need more information in the hands of communities to be able to look at those decisions.
I've been wondering if the beginning to grow climate action hubs and climate action networks could be a place where we could start getting some of that action on the ground, because they seem to be well placed, you know, Moray Climate Action Network, for example, or Northeast Scotland Action Network, a climate action network. They're there, and that's kind of what they're in place to do. And maybe that's the next big step that some of those networks need to be kind of taking on, is those kind of community discussions to start getting people thinking about 20-minute neighbourhoods and what that means, or in terms of more rural areas, that kind of sustainable living approach that we're aware of. Okay, I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin, who does have some questions related to the recent case that we now know has changed, but so he can ask these questions. Mark, he's joining us online.
Thanks, Cats Commissioner. Good morning. I just wonder maybe to kick off, now that the Miller versus Scottish Minister case decision has come through on Friday, whether members of the panel would have an indication of whether that decision means that NPF4 and the planning system is working as we would have expected, or whether that decision throws up any issues related to how developments will get approval between introductions of different local development plans. Maybe go to Craig first.
I thought you might say that. I'm dreading it. No, I'm not a planning lawyer, and I'll be honest, I haven't read the full details of the case. I tried to read it in the train this morning coming over, but I suppose the gist of it for me is that the way in which the case has been decided and the appeal turned down means that the judges saw the NPF as being the key part of what we're trying to use to deliver housing. I think one of the interesting things for me about the NPF is that it's something we all want to do, is to try and create much more certainty and predictability. And through that, it's trying to put in place a process where the development plan is seen as a prime the prime document you use to try and make a decision on things as well. So for that, if you're developing housing, that means getting your housing sites into the development plan. There's some flexibility incorporated within the NPF to do that, but it's really much more about trying to make sure that's a plan-led approach to make this work. So I think, from my very quick understanding and reading of the case, that's reinforced that even more. The interesting thing will be when the new local development plans start coming in, as to what they see and what flexibility they add and how they deal with this. So I still think, again, I've said it again, we're on a bit of a journey with this. So we'll need to see how the local development plans refer to this and use this, because once an LDP comes into place, its policies are more recent than the NPF's as well, although they have to obviously relate to one another. So there's a journey to go on, but I do think what it's trying to do and what I think has been reinforced by the case is that the primacy of the development plan is going to be really, really quite important. Mm. But I could have that totally wrong, but hopefully not.
Okay, anybody else? Anything to add on that? No? Okay, such fresh material there. I that's the impression I have too, Craig, but we might both be wrong. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs with a number of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask a question with regards to some of the concerns which have been put to the committee around wording in MPF4 policies being unclear and leading to inconsistent decision-making. We've heard specific concerns with regards to SEPA's strict interpretation of MPF4. So just wanted to ask if the panel could provide examples of how that has been the case over the last year and how you think that could be addressed. Whoever wants to come in on that.
To pick on somebody. Jenny.
I mean, there's probably not any specific examples of particular cases I could give as such, but we are certainly hearing from our members that, of course, there is quite a lot of uncertainty within some of the wording, within particular policies, just due to sort of a lack of clarity around how they should be interpreted, and that is quite challenging. One of the examples I have here is Policy 22, on flood risk, which I imagine is the SEPA one that you referred to before. And what we are hearing, that the way that it's written has resulted in quite a rigid interpretation of that policy, and the consequence of that being that it's not open to innovation and design that could, in some contexts, not all perhaps, but in some contexts, allow for the practical alleviation of some of that risk. Mm. And even in circumstances, you know, when there might be a suitable design solution, consent can't be granted because local authorities essentially are just struggling to really find their way around that particular policy. Another example probably is Policy 3 on biodiversity. And in this case, I would say it seems like it's the looseness of the language in this policy rather than its rigidity. So looking at it from the other side, that's causing issues. So requirements such as enhancing biodiversity and using proportionate measures, a lot of our members are really just struggling to grasp, well, what does this mean in practice? What does this look like? And particularly for each individual context. So I know that they've been eagerly awaiting guidance in this area, and I know that some of our members and also ecologists that I've spoken to have been using the English metric while they're waiting for the Scotland equivalent to help them through this process. Those are probably the two key examples that came up, that have come up time and again when I've had discussions about this topic.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. And I know from some of the evidence we've had, it's especially sites in settlements with flood defences that becomes really proportionately difficult to take forward. Katrina, do you want to come in on that?
To add, we don't particularly have concerns with the wording, which we think is actually, the looseness is actually helpful for interpretation. But what we're finding is that there's quite a wide range of interpretation of the policy and then misuse of the policy. So some of the case studies that I've been given examples for, some Policy 6, which is to do with forestry and woodland, we've actually had an example of a planner turning around and using that to reject planning application in a private domestic garden due to trees in a garden. Now, that doesn't actually, if you read Policy 6, clearly it doesn't relate to garden trees, it's woodland. Similarly, worries and concerns related to Policy 10, coastal development, you could read that and come to the conclusion that actually development in most coastal communities is now not possible if you're within the 200-year flood area. So I think it's down to interpretation rather than the wording.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. Thank you for that. I wanted to go back to some points you said earlier, Elsa, with regards to community wealth building, which is something we've been looking at as a committee as well, but just wondered in terms of MPF4, whether or not you feel it has gained greater prominence in planning decisions since the adoption of MPF4. If you have any examples of what that might look like.
I won't have any examples that I'm able to give you, but my understanding of that is that it was introduced at the LDP stage and therefore isn't strongly reflected within NPF4 itself, and whilst very supportive of the intentions of community wealth building, it perhaps felt bolted on from other policies rather than necessarily something that was fully embedded within NPF4. But I do appreciate there are other policies within that support sort of sustainable community growth and other aspects that then support community wealth building. But I'm afraid I don't have any specific examples for you.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to
come on? Can I just kind of back on that? I tend to agree with what Elsa said around the policy for community wealth building. I remember when it first came out, there was a lot of discussion across the profession as to exactly where planning fitted with it. And I know there are the five pillars of community wealth building. I think the key one was one around land and property. And even that, it was a bit tenuous to see what the link could be. I think it was North Ayrshire did some interesting work on that and tried to see how best that could be mapped out and what planning could contribute to it. I don't know where that is, but it might be a useful place to go and look at to see where that connection can be made.
Yeah, thank you for that. That's helpful. One of the things which I think when I was certainly speaking to members of the public, my own constituents, during our work we were doing in MPF4, was that infrastructure first approach. And I think for a lot of people there is frustration often where development's taking place and a new primary school, GP surgery investment, even just play parks which are promised or part of designs not being delivered. And I think we had some good examples, Bertha Park up in Perthshire, where a secondary school was built early in that development to plan. So just wondered whether or not over the last year, and obviously that's quite a short period of time, whether or not that has started to be embedded in planning and that change to look towards that infrastructure first approach, because it's something I think certainly members of the public wanted to see MPF4 deliver.
Okay. I'll go if you want. My feeling is that people want to do it, but I just think given the public sector and public sector finances just now, that's taken the legs away from it, to be honest with you. It's very difficult to try and get the money to make these things work at the moment. And I think we're in a wee bit of a position where we just don't know where that's going to happen, because it depends on some public sector as well as private sector involvement as well. And even the private sector are struggling to try and get the finances together for that. And I know at a more strategic level there is there's a group being set up to try and help deliver the infrastructure first process and relate it to the National Planning Framework, PIPAG, the Planning Infrastructure and Place Advisory Group. It's met, I think, I'm not involved in it, but I think it's met with 3 or 4 times already, and it's bringing together a lot of different stakeholders who have an interest in actually and an ownership of some of the resources to do this. So, again, I think they're on a journey in trying to pull this together to see where that goes as well, but it's not helping the fact that there's been very severe restrictions on public sector, particularly capital growth, finance.
Share with you, which Craig has just reminded me of a commercial development in the Cairngorm National Park where the developer very sensibly built the car park first before doing anything else, which was a huge cost to themselves and a good investment, but it's been very well received. But the critical bit of connecting it up to the public infrastructure of the path, the active travel path there, is proving more challenging because that needs funding from within the public sector, and that's where hit a stop. So it's actually seeing it through. The intent is there, the will and the need to do it is there, but actually the funds to deliver it are challenged. Mm-hmm.
And how do you think that could be reformed? You know, when you think of planning gain, the amount of money which a new built house, for example, provides that local authority, that money just then being lost in the system or lost in translation is often what people will complain hasn't happened, the new primary school, especially around GP surgeries. Here in Edinburgh, it's one of the biggest issues, given the amount of new build homes we've had and will have, you know, the predicted developments we're going to be seeing. And does that need to change? So that money, having been allocated, has to go to the projects the community were led to believe they would enjoy. It seems to happen in terms of retail in communities, so why not public services, and why is that not necessarily being better managed within MPF4? Because it doesn't seem, from what you've said, that's really improved the picture.
I do think that there are monies coming in through Section 75 agreements and the like. Although one of the things which sometimes stops development happening on the ground is agreement and it's the signing off of the Section 75 agreement, which is something I know come up through discussions I've been having with lots of people about the need to try and make that more effective process. So that there's maybe something about how we can do that. And there's been talk of looking at some examples in England where there's a common approach to it and a common sort of documentation which can be used to that as well. The reality of a Section 75 is that it can sometimes be the developer doesn't want it signed because they don't have the money to actually to give at that time, or it can be the planning authority because it's got an issue with it as well. So I think there's a need for a much more collaborative and more transparent way of trying to try and make that happen, and that would bring in the resources. I do think of the resources that come in from Section 75 agreements. Probably the issue just now is they're not aggregated enough to give us some of the big ticket issues which we're looking for. The cost of a school will be more than just one housing development, for example, will be a number of different housing developments. So there's a job to be done in pulling all that together and making sure you can get the resource from that, the finance from that, to actually help to build and to fund the building of that particular school, for example. So, and I think the other thing is that there are some planning authorities who will not actually insist on planning gain because it's not worth their while, because it will mean that the development itself will not be viable for them. Mm. Particularly, I think, in parts of the west of Scotland, they're just keen to get the housing in the first instance because that's what's needed. There might actually be some capacity in schools anyway because of the population, demographics there. So it's different, happening differently in different places.
Thank you. Thanks for that. Thanks, Karina.
Gordon, you want to come in with some questions?
Okay. Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, panel. I've got a number of questions I want to ask. First of all, I want to start with local place plans. I know certainly in my constituency, a number of the communities, including Balerno, have worked on local place plans. Has NPF4 helped the development of local place plans? Is it quite widespread, the creation of these local place plans, and is there any examples of them having an impact on planning decisions? Maybe come to Jenny first.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, local place plans, it's not a subject that we've received a lot of feedback on, actually, from our members. So there are others that probably have more insight, and I know that Planning Aid Scotland are doing a lot of work with communities on this area, so that they're probably best placed to give you specific examples of how that's playing out. But what I would say is that there is the potential for an infinite number of local place plans to come about from the reformed planning system, which is a great thing, but associated with that there are concerns about the lack of resources within certain communities as well as within local planning authorities as to how this plays out in practice. So, for example, you might have a resource-rich community that has a lot of the in-house skills and funding in order to create a very detailed and efficient local place plan. But that's not necessarily the case in every community across Scotland, which I'm sure you're aware. In terms of, you know, resources and internal skills, it's not an equal playing field. So there are a few concerns as to how the quality of local place plans will vary. And you might even get some communities that won't be able to produce a local place plan at all. Yeah. I'm afraid I don't have any specific examples of that, but these are the concerns that we're hearing from our members.
Thank you. Craig?
I don't think it's just NPF which is the driver behind local police plans. It comes from the Act, the 2019 Act itself. Yeah. But you'll know local police plans have to have regard to the NPF, so that should help drive them. Yeah. The anecdotal evidence I've got is very similar to what Jenny's said around. I think planning authorities understand the value of local police plans. Do you think they could be really useful in bringing that more bottom-up approach to what they're doing and to help with the delivery of some of those policies? The issue is how they can be funded and how they can make sure they're fair as well. So I do know a number of planning authorities, a couple have set up some funds to try and help local communities to deliver a local place plan, or they put advice out as well. But it's a bit of a struggle for them because they're doing other things just now, such as trying to develop their own local development plan as well. So the resourcing issues, I think, has always been something at the back of how we take forward local police plans. And also the equity point, which Jenny made as well, about trying to make sure that these local police plans are inclusive in terms of who they involve. And they're very much about trying to bring the community together with a vision for what they want to do, rather than be divisive and keep people out, so to speak. So if I'm going to say it again, we're on a journey with local police plans as well.
But you quite rightly pointed out that it was brought in with the 2019 Act. So we've had it around for the last 5 years. You know, is there any evidence that they're having any influence on planning decisions? I don't know if Katrina or Ailsa.
We've seen a positive example in Murray, in the town of Elgin, where there's a local place plan that's very constructive and to do with economic growth and cultural growth within the town. And it is being kind of delivered through the delivery or their delivery of some individual projects which are working towards that, achieving that place plan. So I think we're in the early days yet, but right. I definitely see it as a positive thing.
Okay, that's fine.
I think in terms of the resourcing, I was looking at an article written by Nick Wright, and he has combed through all of the local and planning authority websites to find how many local place plans have been registered. He's found 10, right. 4 about to be registered, and 6 pilot projects that he could find listed. So obviously, I think that is not to say there will not be many others that are being worked on across many communities. But I think that makes it clear, sort of, the very small scale that we're talking about the ability of communities to make these, and the plan is only part of the process.
Yeah.
The delivery of these plans is the thing that is also entirely under-resourced, and I think refers back to the conversation we've been having about local authority resources as well as the resources within communities themselves.
Yeah, within communities, we've got a lot of gap sites that blight communities, and I know the local development plans set out opportunities for sustainable use of brownfield land. Looking at the register of vacant and derelict land yesterday, it's part of my research, there are 3,500 empty plots across Scotland, which covers 9,500 hectares. Potentially could house 95,000 homes, just to put it into perspective a wee bit. So does NPF4 help to unlock the use of brownfield sites, or is it a hindrance given that NPF says we now have to consider biodiversity of brownfield land which has been naturalised to be considered determining if the reuse of a site is sustainable? I mean, you know, is it going to unlock these development sites? Who wants Craig? Sorry, Katrina?
The answer is yes and no. Right. A small example, West Coast, a town up in the Highlands, where there are 3 available sites, as you just mentioned there. But because of their the time that's elapsed and ownership issues, actually, none of them are practical for developing as housing sites. And the challenge we have now is we have found for the community an alternative site, but we are being cited back, well, you really should be looking at the 3 sites in the LDP first and demonstrating why they can't be used, which we are obviously doing, but it is slowing down the process of development. And this is a community that absolutely needs housing critically. And yet we're adding another 2 years to the process.
Yeah.
So that's an example of an unhelpful one. Maybe someone's got a positive example.
I don't have a positive example as such, but what I do think the NPF does, it provides the right policy context to try and make sure we remediate and use as much brownfield land as possible for a variety of different uses. The issue we have with vacant and derelict land is the fact it costs money to remediate it. There are issues with ownership and identifying who owns it, as Katrina said as well. And the whole issue of viability because of the costs involved in actually bringing it up to spec. And we don't really have the funding to make that work as well. If you're putting it onto the private sector, they have to work out how that works for them, and that might make a development unviable as well. So we need to think through where the public sector can help with that once it's got the resource. I don't think it has the resource at the moment, but the ideal way of doing this would be to, have some sort of model where the public sector can actually help with the remediation and provide sites which are ready to develop on as much as we possibly can. But that's a long way away, I think, just given the financial circumstances we're in.
I mean, certainly what you've said in general terms is right, but we're sitting on 460 sites that were previously used for residential housing. Some of them have lain empty for 10 years. So that there has to be a mechanism to unlock these residential sites, because what we're doing in Lothian, and I can only talk about Lothian, is we're building on good arable land in a country that can't feed its population, as in the UK.
Yeah. I think there's another issue with the where vacant and derelict land is located. Looking at the register, very large majority of it's in Glasgow, Lanarkshire, west of Scotland. Quite often there are areas where the housing market is not seen as an attractive one for developers. So again, that brings in, is there a role there for the public sector and for public sector social housing to be the way forward for that, or can the public sector help in some way to help make the market for that particular site as well? I think you'll find most of the vacant land in the more prosperous areas where there is housing demand will have been taken up more or less. Yeah. It's in those other areas because there's that sort of market failure on that side.
Okay. So my last question is, we've received conflicting evidence in the balance struck in NPF 4 between protecting areas with carbon-rich soils and the development of renewable energy infrastructure. How do we get the balance right? Do you want to come in on that?
I was going to say, that's a particular challenge in the Highlands, where we're seeing the need for so much renewable energy infrastructure, and there's so much opportunity there. And yet it is on carbon-rich soil. I think it's got to be about balance. We need that infrastructure, we need that grid. So it's about how we tread lightly on the ground in the best way possible. But we can't put a blanket ban on building on carbon-rich soil. It's got to be moderated.
OK. Anybody else like to come in? No? OK. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Gordon. Pam Gosall.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. We know that fewer people are applying to build major housing developments, and there's delays, we've heard today as well, in planning applications to be approved. And also, the Scottish Government has cut the planning budget by 43%. So I wanted to ask the panel, that do you think the policies in the MPF4 actually are helping to make good quality homes that people want to actually live in, and what else can be done?
So obviously we all want to build good quality homes. I don't think there's anyone in my profession out there that would want to build a bad quality home. There are other vehicles for ensuring that there are good quality homes, our building standards, for instance. So I think NPF 4 supports building good quality homes well. But at the moment, and I think it's because we're in its infancy, and because we are, and you'll have heard the word resource, lack thereof, is absolutely the strongest theme. We're finding real challenges on the coalface. So, you know, I represent the body that are putting the planning applications in. And at the moment, what we're seeing is a delay. We're seeing reasons for refusal. We're seeing unsure planners who are lacking resource. we are seeing an impact on economic development as a result. So where a planning proposal is slowed down in the process, ultimately the economic output will be affected. So we would like to see a bit more tolerance in this in the early stages at the moment.
Just Katrina on that, mm-hmm. just going back to that, you've obviously said delays, reasons for refusal, mm-hmm. and planners' lack of resources. These are obviously have been highlighted yeah. in the committee before as well. When you talk about working at it early, what is it you're meaning here? Because these are three different areas. One's obviously the resourcing and the planning, but the reasons for refusal as well, because obviously reasons for refusal will have to be a material degree, going mm-hmm. back to planning documents and policies. So what else can be done there?
We're more concerned about reasons for delay. Okay. So, for instance, the amount of material that needs to be submitted to support the ecological case for a submission, which could realistically be conditioned in the process. I mean, we are very well informed about an archaeological impact on a development, which will be then conditioned during the process, so that you'll have an initial report that will go in with your application. If there's likely to be findings in the ground, then there's a process to be followed, but it won't actually delay the decision-making. Whereas if you take an ecological issue, let's say, for instance, bats, there's a huge timing issue to do with that. And so we're seeing delays of up to a year waiting for additional reports to come in. And in our collective opinion, we think that that could actually be conditioned into the process rather than waiting. So a simple case study, maternity batteries can be surveyed until you reach the month of May. So if your application was put in August last year and your ecologist has put a desktop study saying we recommend further studies of the bats, we would like that to be conditioned rather than the response which we're facing at the moment is for the planner to say, well, I cannot consider this decision until I have all of those surveys, which then delays the process. So the impact then, there's an economic impact on that development and a cost impact on the development, which we think could be better dealt with. And that's why I'm saying I think there's a teething issue here at the beginning of rolling out the policy where it's too much of a knee-jerk reaction at the moment to have a very strong response, whereas in actual fact we could be a bit more tempered in how we're dealing with it.
Thank you.
Before you go on to your next question, I've got a question and then I'm going to bring in Gordon with us up on the back of that. But just Katrina, could you just explain for those of us who are not into the planning lore what conditioned actually means?
Planning can be approved, so you can be granted approval on the basis of a series of conditions, and those conditions need to be discharged as you then develop that project forward. So this is particularly important when it comes to funding. So if you take, for instance, a community project, which is funded in stages, so community building a new housing proposal, for instance, they will have their initial funding to get to planning. Then they'll probably get some additional funding to get to building warrant and compliance. And then they'll look for their proper capital funding. And that whole process takes time. But to unlock the funding, they need to get the planning approval first. Mm. But if we say right at the beginning, we're going to wait a year for that BAT survey, which we can't carry out, we've then inhibited that community from delivering the project that they're trying to deliver. We're making it more difficult. Mm. So I think what I'm flagging up are some of the unintended consequences. So we're fully supportive of the long-term objective, but the implication and the actual attention to the detail of it is thwarting developments. And you will see that some communities are just going to give up because it's so difficult for them.
Okay, and you're saying that there's precedent. We've got something we can point to in terms of the archaeological experience with archaeology.
Exactly, because yeah. There's a very clear position there where you'll have a desktop study, and then when you actually get to site, so when you're actually digging in your trenches, you'll have a watching brief and you'll have an archaeological expert come along and watch. And so it's monitored and it doesn't delay the process. And I think that same level of kind of a sensible approach should be applied to ecology in the same way.
Okay. Craig, did you want to come in on that?
Yeah, it's about conditions, a bit broader than that. I think there's a general issue. I put out a call for ideas last year, asking for people what the issues were with the planning system. One of the things that came back was proportionality in what's asked. So it goes on to Katrina's point. And I think there's a bit to be discussed because I think we'll get into a little bit of a rut in the way planning works and just adding more and more impact assessments and conditions and things like that. I think one of the issues we have as perhaps a profession is how we handle risk. And I think we've become a very risk-averse profession. And there's perhaps something to have a discussion about how we can get better at using risk. Like many organisations, most organisations will have their own corporate risk register, which they'll identify what the risks are, what the probabilities of that risk happening and what mitigation you put in place to make that happen. Is there something we need to introduce to the planning side of things which gives us that better understanding of where we can take the risk or where it's less of a risk than we perhaps think it is? So I think there's a discussion to be had about that, which will touch on the whole proportionality side of things as well.
Okay, thanks. Gordon?
It's just a bit of clarification. I can understand that individual sites there are problems with and it creates problems for developers. But am I right in saying that in the year to March 23, there were over 24,000 homes built in Scotland across all tenures, and that it's double the rate per head of population of Wales and a third higher than what's happening south of the border in terms of rate of completions, and it was the highest affordable homes that's been built in Scotland since the year 2000?
Be a word for that. I don't know the figures.
Okay.
I pick up your next question.
Yeah. Thank you, convener. MPF4 seeks to deliver both compact and urban growth and development that is balanced between areas of high and low demand. Is there any evidence of this, these aims being delivered?
I think, as I've said again, we're still at early stages with this, but what I do think is the approach and the policy context which is provided by the MPF puts a very strong emphasis on quality place, quality of place. It talks about the six distinctive characters of place. It talks about 20-minute neighbourhoods as part of that process as well. I do think the other thing more generally about the way in which the Act, the 2019 Act, provided things as well, and the guidance, the local development plan guidance, talks a lot about place being the key emphasis of what LDP should be about. So less policy, more about place, more about ambition as well. So I definitely think that's there. Whether it's having the impact yet in terms of developers are listening to that, I'm not entirely sure. I'm sure some will be, and I think they're on a journey there again, if I can use that phrase. But I do think that as we see the evolution of local development plans, that's going to become a much more important part of what will be the essence of what the LDPs are like. So I do think place is going to be really important, and compact place as well.
We're seeing good evidence of it, and we're seeing that density is extremely helpful, and it's being delivered. I've got a good example of one project where it's car-free, and that's been accepted because it's urban, and it's allowed the design of the proposal to be focused on the placemaking rather than the car. So I think it's a really strong policy. I do, though, think that it needs to be tempered for rural development. Different types of different solutions are needed in rural settings.
There's been a few questions around sort of what we know, number of applications, and that sort of thing. But there's also been questions very much related to that place scale impact and that sort of understanding and development of good sustainable places. And I would say that that's maybe something where we just don't have enough information yet, because we're asking for place scale impact, but what we're monitoring remains relatively numeric in terms of number of decision, number of units, and we're not necessarily measuring sort of that quality and place scale impact. And I think that that's something that could be examined for the future.
Can I come back on that, but not to contradict Shales, but just to mention something. One of the roles I have in my job is to set up a new performance and improvement framework for planning authorities. And we're started piloting that in the last month or so. One of the things we're trying to do with that is start measuring the place outcomes and the outcomes delivered by planning authorities. It's incredibly difficult, and again, dare say that we're on a journey with it, but it's something we really want to try and do, because that's something that came through very strongly from the call for ideas, which I mentioned earlier on, I put out there, that we want to get away from some of the more numerical how quickly you process a planning application, how many are done, to some of the more qualitative and quantitative stuff around, what place outcomes you have, about the quality of service, about the culture of the organisation as well. So we're not there yet, but it's something we need to try and do. And, of course, if you measure certain things, that affects behaviours, hopefully. So it should hopefully embed that place-based approach.
Thank you.
Jenny, do you want to come in?
Just to say I agree with everything that's been said by the panel. I would say that, there is a very much a central focus to placemaking that's coming out of MPF4. And I know that the place principle is something that RTPI Scotland has been a huge supporter of over the years. And obviously the place principle does feature in MPF4. I think it's referenced 6 times, when I did a search. And I think the place principle really has kind of moved the dial in terms of placemaking, and we are seeing, I think, a lot more concerted effort to break down the silos. And I think we can see a lot of good work happening, particularly in certain areas. So I've heard of good things happening in West and Bartonshire, Fife, Aberdeen, Glasgow, as some of these key areas where they have a really dynamic group of people who are able to collaborate and break down those silos and do really good things. But I would say that it's maybe difficult to understand to what extent that's happening because of the individuals within that group, and or is it happening because of MPF4 itself? It's difficult to say what the influence is there, because I think it's safe to say that it's certainly not something that's happening everywhere. So just to say, I think it is still quite early days in terms of what the impact is of MPF4 specifically on how this is moving.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to pick up a couple of questions to explore around the rural revitalisation that MPF4 aims to produce. And Katrina, you were saying when we were just talking about the compact urban growth and finding that balance that we need a different approach, different solutions for rural areas. And I wondered if you, what evidence you've had around rural revitalisation. But also I have a very specific question which has been raised to me by someone in my region around policy number 17, which is on rural homes. And in the past, they've been able to, so this is actually an architectural firm, design and build, and they've actually been able to find sites in infill and gap sites or extending on an existing group of domestic buildings or non-domestic buildings. And now with MPF4, the council that they work within has turned them down on being able to use those sites. And maybe there's a bit of a conflict around the need for that space for biodiversity happening there. But on the other hand, we've got such a desperate need for housing in rural areas. So just wonder if you are aware of those kinds of things?
Yes, I think I've had similar case studies presented to me. So what we've seen is some planning authorities taking very literally the requirement to focus development on sites that are identified in the LDP. And if a site isn't in the LDP, then it can't be developed. So I have got numerous examples from practices who are trying to deliver individual houses in the wider countryside, observing all the things that we need to do, because it's not straightforward to build in the wider countryside, and yet still being rejected because the site specifically is not in the LDP. Mm-hmm. Now, they're not taking these applications to the point of being rejected. They're taking them to pre-app, and then they're getting a negative response and then not taking it any further. So if you're looking at the statistics, you won't see lots of rejections, but you'll just the reason why they haven't progressed those projects is because of the pre-app. But I'd like to just go back to the rural development, because I actually would like to see a little bit of a step change in rural areas, where we've got a number of projects we're developing with Community Homes Trust, and we're seeing that our general feeling is that density could be higher in rural areas, but we are still dragging a little bit behind, or local authorities are a little step behind, and wanting to see a much less dense development in rural areas. But in actual fact, if land is precious, we need to still consider a dense solution in a rural setting. I think perhaps I'm not explaining myself completely clearly here, but if you take a village where the pattern is individual houses with lots of garden space around it, that then sets a pattern, which then could be interpreted as a precedent to be followed. But if you have a development site where you could get a cluster of 10, 12, 15 houses, do they need to follow that same pattern of large space around them? Mm. Not necessarily, I think, is the answer. And I do think that we need to be looking at dense solutions in rural areas in the same way that we're, in a similar way to the way that we're looking at it in urban places.
I would agree with you there. Certainly, I've seen great examples of terracing or two and maybe even three-storey houses that actually work really well in the landscape. I know there's a sensitivity of going high, and you've got to be really thoughtful about where you do that, but I've seen it working really well. Also, two-storey where it's one and a half high, that kind of thing. But also, I would say that from what I've observed in the terracing is that you're also going to be, because you've got houses all next to each other, you're helping with kind of the whole heating of the, you're heating a block of houses and flats rather than individuals, which takes a lot more energy to do that. But just a bit more, so just to come back to the specific example, so I would imagine that this example where they were applying to build housing on an existing infill to a gap site or extending existing policy or existing group of domestic and non-domestic buildings, those would have been in the local development plan, surely, because there's housing that already exists. So there's something else at play there, and maybe it is something to unearth around maybe some other policies that are being kind of looked at.
Indeed.
There. Does anyone else have any thoughts around the kind of piece of MPF4 and how it's contributing to the rural revitalisation so far? I know we are on a long journey, and this is maybe too early to tell, but anybody else? Jenny?
Yeah, I mean, I have spoken to some of our members who are based in rural local authorities, Shetland being one example, where, you know, there's a lot of reliance on windfall development there in terms of providing the necessary housing. Mm-hmm. But if you look at that in terms of Policy 16, there's a definite conflict there where that kind of development could be interpreted as being prohibited, but it's so vital in the rural context. So our members have just highlighted to us the importance of viewing MPF4 as a complete document rather than looking at individual policies in a very prescriptive way. And local living is another example of policy. I mean, we've touched on this before, where we've heard that, you know, some rural local authorities are looking to implement this using more locality hubs and co-location of services rather than expecting rural communities to move completely away from reliance on their private motor vehicle, which is unrealistic. All the evidence I've heard is anecdotal, but I think, you know, these are just some of the examples of how this is potentially playing out in rural areas.
Mm. That's what I mean. I'm just hearing you talk about that. So certainly in my region, in the Highlands, we've got this big push for renewable energy, and I'm coming across companies that are going to need to house hundreds of workers on a site that will be a temporary housing. Have you come across that? I mean, I wonder how planners are going to handle that kind of situation where we basically got to build a village for a number of years, and then, I mean, I know the idea is to maybe take that village down and move those houses elsewhere, but Katrina, have you come across that?
Not any specific examples, but yes, we are well aware of the lack of housing for big new projects that are being delivered, the Bedford Hospital in Fort William being an example, although it's temporarily on hold. But when that comes forward, which one assumes it will, there will be a massive challenge accommodating the workers that will be needed to deliver it. And so I think what we'd like to see is some joined up thinking, and that it's not temporary homes that are built, but it's homes that then become communities that are then part of an established culture going forward.
Well, certainly, and that's a slightly different situation, because that's actually in a town and the need for worker accommodation there, or not even accommodation, homes, right? Yeah. But this one is a temporary thing where it's going to be, you know, I don't know what the number is, but many, many houses for a number of years, so it's really more like an accommodation situation. But I guess that's something we'll come across, and hopefully MPF4 won't hinder that and will support it. I'm going to move on, and I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callahan, who's joining us online with a number of questions.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you. I'm interested in the resourcing of local authority and national planning departments. So has there been any improvement in the resourcing and the proposed changes to planning fees on available resources? What impact is that expected to have? Thank you.
Who wants to pick that up? Jenny.
Yeah, I mean, resourcing is a huge issue. I think it comes up in every conversation that we have about planning, and it's something that's come up a few times in this session already. I mean, RTPI Scotland has been tracking the resourcing question for a number of years, and in our last update, which was published in December of last year, we found that there had been a 28.6% drop in planning expenditure since 2010-2011, and a 2.4% drop between 2020-21 and 2021-22. We also found, you know, there's a workforce crisis at the moment in local planning authorities, and we found it to be at its lowest level in 5 years. So there's certainly a lot to be done, and compounding this is the fact that a lot of unfunded duties were introduced by the 2019 Planning Act. So, I mean, what I would say, there's no simple answer to this, unfortunately. I wish there was. But what I would say is resourcing very much has the potential to be both a critical barrier and a critical enabler to the implementation of MPF4. But obviously, that's reliant for it to be an enabler. The resources need to be in place to allow that to happen. And I think all local planning authorities are grappling with the same issue, but not necessarily on an equal playing field. So just as an example, we have heard about some local planning authorities able to employ specialists in biodiversity, so they have their own in-house biodiversity officer to assist them with the expertise that are required to interpret Policy 3 and other relevant policies of MPF4. But that's not necessarily the case in all local authorities. Not all of them have that specific in-house expertise. Archaeology is another area where I know it's in a bit of a crisis at the moment, where a lot of funding is being cut to those specialist areas that planning relies on quite heavily. We were very pleased that the Scottish Government released its investing in planning consultation, and that is something that we're definitely going to be responding to. And it's good to see that it looks not just about fees and income generation, but it also looks at smarter ways of working, because I think that is going to be critical, because I think the evidence that we've seen in the past is that greater fees does not result in it doesn't automatically bring about a better service or more resources to planning authorities. So we definitely need to look broader. I think there's something here about process efficiency and understanding that resourcing goes beyond planning as well. So I know that talking about statutory consultees again, I know that there's a lot of they're also going through a resourcing crisis, and we've heard about, you know, some instances where it's taken some statutory consultees over a year to respond to an application that's been referred to them, which then goes back to the delays that we've heard about before as well. So that's probably all I have to say about that at the moment, but yeah, thank you.
That was really helpful response. I think you said plenty. Anyone else want to come in on that, or Craig, and then I'm going to move on, because we're going over time, but this is really important, and we've still got a few other questions to get into.
I'll keep it brief. I absolutely recognise the situation that Jenny's outlined. Just to go back to that call for ideas I mentioned earlier on, which I put out, one of the key things that come back from that across sectors, not just public sector, but from the private sector and the third sector as well, was that resourcing is now a performance issue for planning authorities. They're not being able to do what they want to do, or do it as quickly as they want to do it as well. So I think there are some things we need to do. I think there's a growing urgency for some short-term things to happen to try and overcome some of the issues which we have. Jenny's mentioned the consultation paper, Investing in the Planning System, which Scottish Government have out just now. There's a proposal in there, for example, for a hub, which would bring in some experts, some technical experts, or for people to be brought in when there's a surge on a planning authority. I think that's an interesting concept. The thing we need to guard against is that the people we get to act as those technical experts aren't taken away from already under resource planning authorities. We need to be careful of that. But I do think there's other things we need to do, some short-term stuff. I've been asking questions about, can we get more retired members back in to do certain things for us as well? Can we build a sort of smaller cohort of younger planners who we can accelerate through the system quicker, because a lot of the gaps are at that senior level? Can we look at bringing in other people from other built environment professions, dare I say architects as well, to help us accept that challenge as well? So, and there are things around apprenticeships as well, which is still being progressed, and RTPI are still working on that. But I think the urgency to get some short-term answers in is something which is actually quite important we should be thinking about.
A couple of supplementaries on that, and then Pam's indicated she wants to come in too before Stephanie comes in with her next question. But so there's a couple of things. One, I've heard, so again, it's kind of, we've been talking about how it takes time for applications to move through the process. Something that's been raised with me is, could there be a requirement for reasonable engagement? And so the concern's been raised that because of COVID, where we got used to working from home, quite a lot of planners are working at home. And so there's two pieces to this. One is around how do inexperienced planners kind of get that mentorship and that understanding of how to move processes through. But also, because it's slowing things down, I think on the kind of architect side or the applicant side of things, developer architects, is could there be some kind of requirement to connect a planner within the department with that plan so that there's a way to kind of follow up on things and actually be in touch around the progress of it. So those are two kind of suggestions or kind of questions and suggestions. And then the other one is, I mean, you talked about it, Craig, in a way already, but what I'm really understanding about MPF4 is it is a significant change. It's a mindset change. It's a really big change. Is there any program of education to help planners to embrace these significant changes? So not just bringing in the ecologist who knows it, but actually helping planners get some fundamental training and skill sets around looking at this in a different way.
Okay, if I go back to your first point around customer care, essentially, that's something which came through quite strongly in responses to my call for ideas, so much so as part of our new National Planning Improvement Framework, it's going to be one of the criteria we're looking at, and it's likely that me and my team will undertake an annual customer care review across planning authorities to see what that's like. It's a difficult one because I think a lot of it, as you say, goes back to COVID, but also a lot of it is to do with just pure resources and getting things done. I think there's a role for technology in this as well, and how we can get better at using technology. And I know a number of heads of planning are grappling with what's the best way to do this. Is it just all face-to-face, or is it more technology, or is it a combination of both of them? But I think it's on the radar. I think it's something we need to look at. And that idea of having people in the office they don't have to be in the office, but people around who can mentor people, I think is a good one. That doesn't necessarily have to happen in the office, I say, but there's sometimes a need for it. So I think that can be built in. And I think you've seen more and more planners are going back to the office. I don't know, very few planners who now work from home all the time. The point about upskilling, I think, is a good one. I think one of the ideas behind this hub, which is mentioned in the consultation document just now, a part of that is about upskilling as well. And we need to see how we can make that work. I think, personally, there's a need for some sort of place where we can have a clearinghouse for good practice and for helping people to do things. Me and my team have got a role to play in that, and the thing I'm grappling with in my own head just now is that I think across other sectors as well, we're always very good at identifying good practice and we're actually half decent at sharing it, but actually working with people to apply it and make the difference and make the change is a bit where we always fall down, and I think there needs to be perhaps a more of a concentration on how we do that. That's much more intensive probably much more expensive as well. But the hub may have a role to play in doing that and helping people to make that change.
Great, OK. Katrina, you wanted to come in, and then Pam, do you still want to come in on your SUP?
Yeah,
OK. Katrina.
Very quick point to make that I consulted with one of our heads of planning last week in our chapter in the north, who wanted me to share his point that he would like to see more dialogue between his planners and the applicant, and he would like to see more trust in the professionals that are putting the applications in. He thinks we've resorted to a kind of a checking procedure where everything is checked and challenged, and in actual fact, that's perhaps gobbling up resource that is unnecessary.
So how would you see that happening? Would that be like a kind of in-person meeting, kind of initial discussion or a discussion at some point in the process?
I think that the pre-app process is extremely helpful. That lays out what you need to submit. Then you submit what you've been asked to submit, and then if there are any missing pieces there or any areas that need further work and challenge, there's a dialogue, and then that evidence or submission is produced. But it could be a much more positive process.
Okay, thanks for that. Pam.
Thank you, Convener. Craig must have known that I'm going to talk about technology. He did mention it. Craig, just going back to that obviously technology is coming in, AI is around as well, which is moving at such a fast pace. So where do you see, can you give me a little bit more about on that, where do you see that will help planning and planners? We know it could help with efficiencies and save that time that planners can use elsewhere. Also, things that I've looked at in the past is that planners actually have their, whether it's a laptop, iPad, whatever, to take on site and do the reports there. So things are done rather than coming back to the office. And these are examples I've seen in England as well. So more efficient and technology and devices, how that's going to play, yeah.
I think there's absolutely a role for it. I think there's different ways in which technology can help. It can help us with having a bit more of a transparent planning system, planning service, and making it something people can understand. There's some really good technology in visualisation, for example, which give people a better idea than looking at a map. I love looking at maps, but not everybody does. So there's a bit about that. I think there are some things around the end-to-end process and how planning, particularly planning applications, done and the different sort of touch points for that, and how that can be made to work in a much more effective and efficient way and perhaps a much more transparent way as well. I do think there are some really interesting digital technologies out there which help with engagement between communities, planners and developers as well, which can help with that process. I've seen a lot of different things being developed through that. But the key thing for me, which I think is a real game changer in this, is investing in spatial data. If we have an open and accessible and transparent national spatial data set, which gives us the evidence which we all can see, that can then help us speed up some of the decision-making processes and also have a much more robust approach to it as well. That requires an investment. It's happening. It's absolutely happening through GIS systems and whatever. But I do think that spatial data aspect can be something which, and particularly, will bring in the place-based approach, which we talked about earlier on, because you'll look at things by the lens of place rather than just the statistic.
Thank you.
Thanks. Just on that, we've got three more questions, but I've got a quick sup on that. Cadastral system. Do you think that would be useful?
What's a cadastral system?
Great. Jenny?
I used to work as a planner in Australia, in Victoria, where they had a freely available online mapping cadastral system, which I think is what you're talking
about, absolutely.
Where people could plug in their address and look up, you know, their property and all of the planning controls that were applicable to that particular property. I'm talking about it in the past tense because I'm no longer there, but I'm sure it's still in place. When I came back to this country, I was actually, this is just more of a personal reflection, but when I came back to this country, I was actually quite surprised that there wasn't anything of that level in place here, because it did just provide for that level of transparency that Craig was talking about before, where you could clearly see what was applicable to your site, and you could see all the requirements that you would have to do to get a particular proposal underway with the local authority. So yeah, I love maps, so I'm all for having that spatial data that's publicly available, transparent, open to all. I think that is hugely important. Yeah, so if we can get that up the ground in this country, I think that would be very valuable.
Great, good. Glad to hear you support that. I'm talking to the government about that, because I for all of the reasons that you're saying there, that it would just be hugely, I think it could really help move a lot of things forward. Okay, Stephanie, we jumped in with some supplementaries between your two questions. Do you want to come back in with your question?
Yes, thanks very much, Convener. I think Kay's covered quite a bit of it there as well, talking about ideas for the future, about that young cohort of planners being accelerated, mentors, apprenticeships, etc. So I'm quite interested as well. Obviously, there's the Scottish Government bursary funding as well for postgrad planning too. And I'm wondering, has there been some progress actually made in attracting people into planning education already? And is there anything else that wants to say about directing people recruiting people directly into the profession? Thanks.
Some nodding heads. Did you catch that? So basically, what are we doing to attract people? I think that's your job, Craig, isn't it?
That's everyone's job, to be honest. We should all be doing it. Well, one of the things I'm saying to a lot of people just now is, can you please stop slagging off planners in public, because that doesn't make it an easy job to bring people into the profession and to make it a decent career destination. So, yeah, I think we're still in a bit of a perilous place, to be honest with you, but I think there's a lot of things happening behind the scenes which will soon come to fruition. I think if you look at the apprenticeship model in England, it's actually had a really interesting, I think it's brought in 400 planners or something, Jenny, so from different backgrounds as well. So there are, and the good thing about that is they are almost available immediately, because you're training them on the job and there are people there. So you're not waiting for people to do a four-year degree. Well, you are, but you can work with them during that period as well, and they can do certain things. So, and I know some universities are looking at more sort of practice-based approaches to learning on the job, which would be a similar type of approach. It's just not as formal as an apprenticeship. So, yeah, but I do think there's something about us trying to present the profession as being a good thing. Too often we are seen as bureaucratic, we are seen as grumpy, we are seen as not helping, whereas the reality of, I've said this before, I became a planner because I wanted to make things happen, and I think the majority of planners want to do that as well. It's become an overcomplicated process now. And probably over bureaucratic to a certain extent as well. So there's a need to try, and this focus on place, I think, can be a really, really valuable tool for us to show that that's what planners are, the place profession, that it makes great places for people as well. So changing that narrative, I think, is incredibly important.
Okay, thanks. Yes, we're doing what we can here in this committee. Absolutely. To help that. Jenny.
Yeah, just a quick point. I would agree with everything Craig has said. I think also we need to do a lot more in making people aware that planning exists as a profession. I mean, I know that I didn't know that planning was a profession I could choose until I stumbled into a position as a town planning assistant, not knowing what it was at the time. And I think any time I've spoken to anybody who's at that secondary school level, they might be taking geography, and in that geography class, they're doing things that are essentially planning, human geography, but they don't know that that's what they're doing. They're very much unaware of that. So I think there needs to be these communications happening with schools. We need to get into the schools and make secondary school pupils aware that this is an option for them. Because I think that's lacking, and I think people are doing it. I know of some of our members who do on their own, off their own back, on their own initiative. They go into schools and they present to students, but it's very much on a sort of piecemeal ad hoc sort of basis, based on the time that they have. There needs, I think, to be a more concerted effort amongst the profession to do that and to get the message out about how great planning is.
Yeah, certainly, and with one kind of drop into a busy curriculum, how do you kind of get that follow through? Certainly, I have a sense that any young person who's concerned about the climate and nature emergency, planning, go into planning, because you can really have a great effect there. Okay, I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin. He's got a question, and then we've got one more. Mark.
Thanks, Kavina. I just wanted to ask members on the panel, what progress there has been in terms of delivery of the 18 national developments, And I know we're still early on, but just ask if there are any where you have any concerns that delivery is maybe off track.
Who wants to pick that one up? You don't have to go through all 18 of them, but it might be very early stage for that.
I don't have anything to say about anyone in particular. I'll go back to two things I said earlier on in the session. One is the state of capital finances is making things difficult, and so I imagine that means that some of these will be reliant upon that, and that might be having an impact. But the second thing is, hopefully in a more positive way, is I mentioned the planning infrastructure and police advisory group which the Scottish Government set up. I would like to think that's got an important role in monitoring, and I think it does have a role in monitoring the progress made against the national developments. And we'll be looking at where those issues or challenges are and what can be done to try and address them.
Okay. Thanks for that. It's maybe something that we can look into ourselves as well. Certainly active travel is a network, it has a budget. It would be interesting to understand how it's progressing. I've got a final question, which is on the national outcomes. So last week, the Scottish Government proposed a new set of national outcomes, including a new outcome for housing. We live in safe, high-quality, affordable homes that meet our needs. And a panellist at that time you've spoken earlier of the difficulty aligning the various national policies. Could a new overarching national outcome on housing help with that alignment? Mm-hmm. And to what extent does the delivery of MPF4 already connect with the existing national outcomes, for example, on communities and environment? Just a small question to end. Anybody got any thoughts about that? A new national outcome for housing? Yeah, Craig.
Maybe not so much about the new outcome. Though I'd probably prefer it to be more place than just homes, but that's just a personal perspective.
Yeah.
Just to let you know that the National Planning Improvement Champion team has been talking to national planning framework people within Scottish Government. Sorry, I get my acronyms mixed up here. But we've been talking to them quite a lot about how they are monitoring the MPF and how it's been delivered. I know they are working away quite feverishly on a sort of monitoring framework. And we've been talking to them about how the work which we do, which is focused very much upon how planning authorities perform individually, how we can have a process where we can perhaps see how we can aggregate that up based on the idea of what outcomes have been achieved at a local level, and how it relates directly to the ambitions of the MPF, and which they will then take on board to look at how the MPF itself is looking at how it's impacting upon other more strategic outcome-based approaches, such as the National Performance Framework as well. So I do know Scottish Government are looking at that. I'm not quite sure exactly where they are with it and when that will become public, but the fact that they're doing that I think is a good thing. They're looking towards the outcome-based approach, and certainly the conversations we're having with them has been very useful in allowing us to see where we can contribute and where we can have a thread between what we're doing and what they're doing, and we don't get in the way of one another as well. So I suppose the key point is that the NPF team is looking at outcomes as a key measure of the effectiveness of the National Planning Framework.
That's very helpful. And of course, the National Performance Framework is linked to the Sustainable Development Goals,
indeed,
which did feature at some point in the early MPF4. So it's kind of like crossing through all of that. Yeah, exactly. Okay. I think we've come to the end of our questions. It's been a really very helpful session and the first of a number of sessions we're going to be doing on the National Planning planning Framework, number four. So thanks so much for joining us this morning. And I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. I now welcome our witnesses on the second and final panel for the meeting this morning. And I just want to apologise for starting quite a bit later than we had anticipated, but clearly it was a good discussion, a good kind of first discussion on this topic of National Planning Framework. We're joined in the room by Kevin Murphy, who's the Head of Planning at Homes for Scotland, and Ailsa Raeburn, who's the Chair at Community Land Scotland. And online, we're joined by Tony Kane, who's the Policy Manager at the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers, otherwise known as ALACHO, and Donna Young, who is the Coordinator at Rural Housing Scotland. And I welcome you all to this morning's panel. And we're going to try to direct our questions initially to someone specifically, but if you do want to come in, please indicate to myself or the clerks, and Don and Tony, if you can do that by typing an R in the chat function, we'll bring you in. And there's no need to operate your microphones. We'll do that for you. And so I'll start with a couple of questions. I'd be interested to understand, and maybe I'll start with Kevin, just so you know it's coming your way, how housing house builders have changed their approach, if at all, to the to development in the light of the policy priorities set out in NPF4, and particularly with regard to climate change and biodiversity.
So I think in first instance, house builders have been adapting their product for a number of years in terms of greenhouse gas emissions reduction in terms of what's produced. And a lot of that has been led by building control, and some house builders as well trying to exceed those standards. So you're probably aware that the new building heat standards came out, new building regulations came out. So that's resulted in new homes now being 83% more efficient than they were in 2015. So that's a simple kind of improvement that's been done in terms of fabric first, technology, etc. But in terms of the submissions they've been putting in, for a number of years they've been improving in terms of what they're looking to do, whether it be biodiversity's obviously got the headlines just now, but they have been looking to expand green space, make better quality places, because ultimately they want to sell homes, so they need to make good quality places in which people can live.
Thanks. I'm going to throw that question to Tony as well.
Similarly, the social and affordable housing sector has been working, improving standards in conjunction with the developing standards around building control over the last 10 years. I think the first thing to say, to acknowledge in any of this conversation, is that the people of Scotland, those that have a house at least, are better housed now than they have ever been in our history. And the quality of what is being built at the moment is, for the most part, extremely high, especially in the social housing sector. We pay a price for that in terms of costs, but these are safe, well-designed, well-laid-out, and very energy-efficient homes, without a shadow of a doubt.
Okay, I don't know if you were watching the session before, which was more focused on the planning side of things. do you have a sense of when you go to apply for the housing, if there's any evidence around the planning authorities having changed their approach because of NPF4?
I mean, the first thing to say is I'm not a practitioner and haven't been for a number of years, so I'm not directly involved day to day with the process of making planning applications, not anymore anyway. But planning is part of the process, and it's something that you engage with as positively as you possibly can, and our members are well experienced and well skilled at that, and they work very closely with colleagues in the private sector as well. I am not of the view that our major problem in the delivery of more homes is planning. I don't share the view of some that think our planning system is the major problem that we have. I think there's evidence, in fact, that our planning system is approving more homes than are currently being built. And you'll be familiar with the Competition and Markets Authority report that was published back in February that said between 8,000 and 10,000 homes a year are being approved at the moment, which aren't being developed. So approvals are outstripping completions by quite a distance. So the planning system is a work in progress. We've been working to improve it over a very long time. It is better than it was. It's not our principal problem in the delivery of more homes, though.
Okay, thanks for that. And just back to you, Kevin, on the kind of planning application side of things.
Certainly, the members have been obviously improving the submissions in line with NPF4 and really highlighting some of the new policies in terms of how they're addressed. Local authorities, I think, lacked maybe a bit of clarity and direction and approached it differently when NPF4 landed last year, in terms of how they assessed information that was already in the system in terms of planning applications. Some took applications that had been to committee and were going through Section 75 negotiations back to committee to reassess them. Some of them did their own assessment on whether or not it complied with the policies within MPF4, and some of them asked developers and indeed applicants generally to provide additional information. So there was a bit of a delay whilst authorities adjusted to the new system.
Thanks. And Elsa, I realise I should have asked those two questions as one because they're kind of the same, but it's kind of like looking at, from your perspective, have house builders changed their approach? And have you got any sense of planning authorities also changing their approach, specifically in relation to climate change and biodiversity policies?
Yeah, I think from the projects that I'm aware of, communities are really aware that standards are increasing and that the costs are increasing. I'm not sure that's always reflected in the funding arrangements that are available from the Principal Funder for Affordable Housing, Scottish Government. So I think there's a mismatch there. I think communities obviously want to build the best quality housing they can because they're in it for the long term. Most of them are going to be holding these houses in the long term, so they're really keen to see best practice as far as possible, but I think it comes back to a point that Craig was making earlier on about this whole issue of proportionality, and that is it reasonable to accept the same sorts of conditions on one or two small community houses in a village where the absolute key outcome is delivering those houses, and if that makes the difference between delivering that development and not delivering it, particularly given where we are with funding, then what flexibility is there? So I think that's one of the good things about MPF4, is it does take that holistic approach, and I think that's how communities tend to work. They think holistically, think about housing and jobs and people and population. And MPF4 does allow that. But I'd say once you perhaps get down to the implementation level, and again, it was a point that was made earlier, some planning authorities are focusing very much on individual elements of MPF4 rather than thinking about holistically what the planning framework is trying to achieve. So that's a long way of saying, yes, communities are aware of these additional requirements, particularly in relation to sort of perhaps some of the upfront costs around the plans that are required. And that's not reflected in the funding arrangements that are currently available. You can certainly see that perhaps slowing down community-led housing. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I'm just going to... So those two questions were about climate and nature or biodiversity policies, but I'm going to pull in a piece around the rural rural house building, and you already talked about kind of community-led development and community and development in rural areas. And I wanted to know if MPF4, and Dawn, I'm going to bring you in on this one as well because of your Rural Housing Scotland hat. Are the policies supporting rural house building as far as you can see, but also that kind of placemaking aspect, and especially where there's the need to support significant economic and infrastructure development, and if not, what needs to change?
Yeah, I think, as I say, it does take that holistic approach. So I think MPF4 in isolation is a good approach. The things that wrap around it, perhaps when you're looking at things like the housing need and demand assessments, that's not reflecting the demand from the economic potential, particularly in the Highlands and Islands. So the system as a whole is not working particularly well. But I think MPF4 is working well. I think what is good about it is the opportunity around rural resettlements. So that, as everyone has said, we're at quite an early stage. But you see that has got great potential, particularly in those areas where we're really suffering from depopulation. I think, again, if we can look at it locally and flexibly and proportionately around issues like 20-minute neighbourhoods and infrastructure first, we know that's not going to be feasible in some of these areas. But if we're focusing very much on outcomes rather than procedure, then I think we'll get there in the end. There's a lot of positive things about MPF4 that over time I'm sure will develop and enable us to deliver more housing in these areas. Was there a second part of the question?
I think you've got that covered. But do you have a sense that MPF4 is going to help us deliver what it aims to do, which is rural revitalisation?
Yes, I think it will, because it will look holistically, but as I say, as long as we're outcomes focused and rather than very specific policy focused. And again, it comes back to a point that was made earlier about some planning officers and some planning authorities being very risk averse. And you can understand why that is, where if you've got a sort of a finance department behind you saying, well, actually, a cost of an appeal is X, so we don't want to get into that position, or we don't want to get into the position where these things take a huge amount of time. But I think that comes back to having good LDPs, good local place plans, where a lot of that discussion has already happened about what's acceptable and what's not likely to be acceptable and what's going to be appealed and not appealed, and what communities are going to object to and not object to. So I think it's part of that part of the process is really valuable. But you know, these things will take time, and it'll take time for MPF 4 to be properly understood, I think, by communities, and understand what the potential is under MPF 4.
Great. Thanks very much. Donna, what from your perspective, what are you hearing about MPF 4 in terms of housing, but also if there's change, if you see the changes in terms of climate change and biodiversity?
So we speak to and have been talking to communities who are working on community-led projects about this, but also from the planning perspective as well, from local authorities and what their view is. In terms of communities, I was actually in a meeting yesterday where it was discussed about MPF4, and the feedback, and I've got some quotes I'd like to just share. I think they're quite powerful. From one community group who are at the stage, or have been at the stage of planning for quite some time for a housing project, they said the agencies involved in planning are conspiring against the local communities in rural and island Scotland. They will do anything to make life difficult, and we are fed up. We are exhausted at the number of hoops we must jump through over a long, unproductive period of time. Now, obviously, MPF4 has only been around for a year, so it's difficult to see if this is affected by previous or the current what's happening with MPF4. But I think it's key to ensure that whilst I agree completely with Ilsa that the concept is good, it's only been a year in, the policy is good, but implementation, I think, is where it struggles. In terms of rural proofing as well, as you well know, rural and island communities they vary greatly. The needs of the communities, the type of housing developments, but the land as well, prove so many different difficulties when it comes to planning. For example, flood risk, coastal erosion, peatland restoration, looking at wildlife, otter surveys. And this comes at a great cost to communities when it comes to planning, that they have to take into consideration and pay for all these other assessments. So I feel that through time, this can be improved. But it also feels as though the planners are struggling with MPF4 to implement it within the rural setting. And I spoke to a planner who, again, another quote for feedback, had said that MPF4 was created, they feel it was created, and very urban and central based. And despite those people maybe visiting an island once or twice on holiday, have absolutely no idea or experience in life there. The lack of holistic approach to remote rural living is evident in many areas of the document. But I feel that that's one view, obviously, from a local authority in planning. They did go on to add third-party agencies are slowing the process, but that is not their fault. And I think that's what it comes in. There are so many different aspects to that planning. And that is, it really deflates communities who are trying to do the best that they can and ultimately create housing to increase their population. It's particularly in areas that are depopulated and are seen and recognised by Scottish Government as repopulation zones. So what can be done to help that process and move it on a lot quicker, instead of applications being stuck in planning for over a year where it is one survey after the next looking at that? So there's definitely improvements to be made.
Okay, thanks. Did we miss an opportunity when we came forward with National Planning Framework 4 to actually look at an urban one and a rural one? Do you think that's where we needed to go?
Yeah, I think in all aspects of everything regarding Scotland, I think we should have urban and rural. I think particularly in housing, and I feel that rural island communities would completely agree with that.
Okay. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to everybody. I just wanted to switch the discussion a wee bit to 20-minute neighbourhoods and local living and so on. It was a good discussion with the last panel about how well everyone's embracing this, but so I'd like to get your views on whether the authorities, you know, builders, developers, communities themselves are getting close to this, because just having listened to the last comments there, I've got a small village called Lugton in my constituency. Its population's about 80. It's incredibly rural, but it's only 15 miles from Glasgow and about 10 miles from Kilmarnock, so there's kind of contradictions about whether it's rural or not, because it's so close to the biggest city in Scotland and so on. So the concept of 20-minute neighbourhood is bound to mean different things in different places, and I suppose one of the questions is the NPF4 flexible enough to recognise that and apply it properly where it can be applied locally better? So just to get a perspective from you on this and whether those three groups are embracing the concept of 20-minute neighbourhood, and is it beginning to show signs that it's working for us, do you think? Maybe, Kevin, would you like to start off?
Yeah, so obviously the government consulted initially on 20-minute neighbourhoods, local living, and it's important to highlight that it's not just the 20-minute neighbourhood concept, it's the local living, because just as you touched upon, there's some communities that won't have everything within a 10-minute walk or cycle, that you can get a wee bit further on a cycle, obviously. But there is a need to start looking at it, because it was consulted on last year. New guidance, as Craig touched upon in the earlier session, only just came out last week. Need for a flexible approach, but also to understand how house building can support existing services within communities, whether that be the post office or the local school, where maybe the school role is declining. But equally, house building can add services. You know, if it's a big enough land release, it could deliver a primary school, or it could deliver retail units. That actually create the 20-minute neighbourhood, or at least expand that 20-minute neighbourhood and the ability to live locally. So that there's a need to kind of look at how sites are brought forward and how they can help existing settlements and ultimately people to live more locally and are encouraged to travel by active travel.
Mm. Ilza?
I would say that probably local living in a 20-minute neighbourhood means something completely different from the Isle of Egg, where I'm the chair of the trust, mm-hmm. and the community that you're talking about. Mm-hmm. So I think it is that local flexibility. Yep. I think the concept is really good. Mm-hmm. Come back to the point about what's the outcome we're trying to achieve here, good places to live where you can access services. So on Egg, you know, the dentist might come every 3 weeks, but there is a school. You've got to send your kids off to the high school to go to Malay. So what does local living look like there? What do people accept? And then what do people accept in your community? And what will people accept in the centre of Glasgow? So I think as long as it's written, and I sort of get the sense that it is moving towards that, it's written relevant to the place. So we're not trying to, coming back to Donna's point, we're not trying to impose national standards on individual places, because it just doesn't work. And that's the sort of thing when you can then actually lose sort of credibility in the whole sort of planning system. And when local people who just want to build 5 houses to keep their kids in the village say, well, you know, the whole planning system's gone completely mad because, you know, imposing 20-minute neighbourhoods. So I think as long as that flexibility, proportionality, awareness of risk, and what's appropriate, then I think it's a great concept.
Mm. Tony, Donna, some comments on 20-minute neighbourhoods? Are we embracing it fully, partially?
So far as the affordable housing supply programme is concerned, absolutely. I think if you look at the way it's delivered in developments of, on average, 25 or 26, and in many communities they are a great deal smaller than that. Particularly in the rural areas. And there's a lot of thought goes into making sure that they are balanced developments, so they include homes for families, for single people, for older people, people with disabilities. It isn't just a matter of here's a set of house types that we're going to beam down. There's some thought goes into how it will fit with local services, the local community and local needs. I think the one word of concern I would raise, though, is that 20-minute neighbourhoods require services within 20 minutes, and it is a genuine struggle at the moment with transport and with a whole range of services to actually deliver them within that type of space. And I think there is one of the risks to what I think is a very positive idea is that, well, yeah, but you've got to make the services available. The GP has to be there, the dentist has to be there. You know, particular challenges in our island communities, but getting a dentist in some urban communities is just as challenging, and you will have to travel. So it's not just a matter of what you build in the area, it's what's being provided as well.
Thanks, Tony. Any comments, Donna?
Yeah, I would just add to what everyone said. I think it's when you look at 20-minute neighbourhoods, they don't fit into life in rural, many rural and island communities. It is more local living. And it's also, when looking at house building and development, it's ensuring and encouraging that well-being is being looked at, that it isn't a case of let's just build houses and that fits, you know, it solves the problem. It is looking at well-being. And this is a huge challenge for rural and island communities because the funding for services just isn't there. And whilst a lot of communities have been depopulating, services have been greatly reduced. So how do we deal with that? How do we manage to ensure that the local living is in place when our services have been reduced, but we want to repopulate? And there's that balance. And I feel with planners that they are completely aware of local living in particular and what's needed and what's available, but they're very restricted and communities as a whole are restricted. Active travel as well is difficult in terms of, again, services for public transport, which in a lot of rural island communities is almost impossible at the moment because services have been reduced. So I think it is just ensuring, again, highlighting what Ilse said, that ensuring that each area is so different. And I think when it comes to 20-minute neighbourhoods and local living, that it's really looked at to suit that particular area and their needs and that community, because it can vary from the Isle of Lewis to Mull to Arran, and then within areas like Applecross, it's completely different to what accessibility they have.
Okay, that's really helpful. Thanks very much, everyone, for answering that particular question. Could I just turn to planning for housing and the much talked about Matlar, just to get your views on the revised changes for the Matlar proposals and whether they are sufficient, acceptable, useful or otherwise. Maybe start again with Kevin.
Yep, so obviously the Matlar figure came around and was applied from MPF4. As touched upon earlier, with Moss End as it landed on Friday. There's a few more questions, shall we say, than answers perhaps, and the housing industry is still digesting that decision, so I won't go into too much detail, but it suggests that the Matlar applied from February last year. Most housing developers and indeed local authorities that I'm aware of were applying the Matlar from when their new LDP came into play. And some of them aren't arriving until 26, 27, 28, 29, so 6 years on from when the Matlar potentially was put in place through MPF4. There's a lot of additional kind of levels of housing need that have been identified. A lot of house builders and indeed local authorities are doing, you know, housing need and demand assessments just now to try and identify the housing need across Scotland, and that's all based on secondary research. Homes for Scotland has undertaken some primary research and gathered data to identify housing need across Scotland, and that's almost 700,000 households are in housing need just now. As Catriona pointed out in the earlier session, some of that can be identified and addressed through sort of looking at bringing up to standard additional or existing properties, but a lot of it can be solved through new house building. But coming back to the Matlar point, that then links into a housing delivery programme. So that's currently, based on what I understand from the Moss End decision, tied into the current housing land audits. Most of them have been around, it's the same sites that keep getting rolled forward. In a previous life, I was looking at one in the Lanarkshire authorities, and 66% of their sites have been rolled forward for 15 to 20 years. So there's reason why they've not come forward. It's coal mining, it's contamination, and the point that Gordon touched upon in an earlier session was naturalisation. Some of these sites are going to have a lot higher biodiversity value than new kind of brownfield sites coming forward, or even greenfield sites for that matter. So the Matlar is a figure that was supposed to be resulting in a local housing land requirement of an ambitious figure, and most authorities are now looking at just going for the Matlar. And that's come out in recent examination decisions at Scottish Borders and Edinburgh as well. We're not looking at ambitious figures to address the housing need that Homes for Scotland, amongst others, are identifying across the country to address the housing crisis and indeed five housing emergencies.
OK. Any other comments on the Matlar from any of the... Tony, Donna?
Yeah, I've been doing things like this for the better part of 40 years, and we have had a number of approaches to trying to estimate housing need or housing demand over that period, and none of them have been entirely satisfactory. because this is an art, not a science, I think it's unhelpful if we attempt to calculate an exact level, a national level or even a regional or local authority level, rather than take a pragmatic approach to understanding what might be required in a particular area or what the demand would be. And I demand in terms of both market housing and demand for affordable and social housing. The matter is a crude estimate, and on top of that, we layer another crude estimate, which is the core of the HNDA. And I think we have been consistently underestimating the scale of demand for housing across Scotland for a very long time. And I think the work that Homes for Scotland did, I think, demonstrates that. I know people have a view about the methodology, but I think it nevertheless represents a reasonable picture. We published a piece of work 2 years ago based on the extent to which the human right to adequate housing is met in Scotland, and we come up with a very similar figure, something like 500,000 households living in homes that don't meet the human right to adequate housing insofar as we can define it, and issues with data around all those things. So I think the practical problem is we obsess around numbers. Local authorities are naturally risk-averse and will want to fall back on, because they don't want to get challenged in court, they don't want to have planning applications appealed, quite rightly, and they will fall back on the safest position, which isn't necessarily the most productive position. And I think we probably need to be, one, a little bit more relaxed about what the number actually looks like, and two, have a slightly broader view. And I think the Homes for Scotland work demonstrates the power of that broader view about how we define need. People can define their own housing need or demand for themselves. If they think they're living in a house that doesn't meet their needs, they're not living in a house that meets their needs. But we are rather inclined to tell folk what does and what doesn't in the way that we measure it. So I think there's something about just being more flexible about understanding what is meant by housing need and demand.
Thanks very much for that. Tony Ailsa, did you want to come in on that point?
I'm not particularly familiar with the process that you're talking about, but I know it came up in the session last week, was around the potential demand for new housing resulting from all the big net zero developments, whether that's renewables or transmission upgrades, etc. And I know the two development agencies are also looking, SOCI and HI are also looking at what that potential demand is, and I don't expect that's actually reflected in the figures that you're talking about. So I suspect those figures are probably out of date given the opportunity that's ahead of Scotland and the housing that we are going to require to enable that we absolutely maximise that opportunity for Scotland. So in that respect, I suspect those figures are probably out of date and actually more work needs to be done on it.
OK, thanks very much. Donna, any comments on the matter that, from your perspective?
Yeah, agreed. I don't know too much about the regime itself, but I will add that having spoken to local authorities, they do feel that there needs to be a more holistic approach looking at needs. And I think when housing needs are done, when housing needs surveys are done in particular, they're outdated as soon as they're done. The needs are ever-changing. And I agree that looking at the local economic growth as well, there's so much potential for housing and for community legacy. And I think it was mentioned in the previous session about temporary accommodation, but then also looking at what legacies can be left in terms of housing as well. And I think I agree with everyone's comments that there needs to be other ways of looking at needs and understanding the actual housing needs rather than just a kind of very general approach.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, everybody. Thank you. Convener.
Very much, Willie. We've got a couple of supplementaries on the Matler. So, Mark, you wanted to come in. Mark's joining us online.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. If I can come back to Kevin, perhaps, to expand on the industry response to the Miller v Scottish Ministers case from Friday. What is your understanding of the impact of that decision in terms of approvals on viable sites over the course of the next few years until we see LDPs being drafted and implemented?
I think it's going to be very challenging for the house building industry to meet the numbers that are expected within the Mathler. So, as touched upon, the housing land audit sets out essentially all the houses that are deemed to be coming forward in the next 5 to 7 years. We're moving to a 10-year pipeline. A lot of the sites within the current housing land audits need to be reassessed as to whether they continue to be included within local development plans. And as I said, they're you know, 2, 3, 4, potentially even 5 years away. So there is going to be a downturn in house building. We've already seen that. We've touched upon, you know, that there's, I think it's 41% reduction in major housing applications of the first two quarters of last year. In terms of site starts, they're down as well, so 24% across all tenures. So it's going to be a very challenging few years, not to mention, obviously, the budget cuts as well that don't feature in those figures.
Yep. And previously, when we were kind of getting towards the end of an LDB cycle, you know, if a developer could prove that some of those allocations within that LDP weren't viable and that the figures that a local authority wanted to achieve weren't going to be made through in that LDP as it reached the end of the cycle, there was a mechanism where a developer could say that, you know, there hadn't been effective land supply. Does this ruling on Friday effectively stop that happening?
In essence, yes, because a lot of local authority LDPs had a safety mechanism, a safety valve, in which it did allow sites to come forward on unallocated sites. So this may affect windfall sites as well that, you know, aren't currently allocated for housing that could be, you know, blighting a settlement of whatever size that they might not be able to be brought forward based on that decision. But we are still digesting that to understand all the potential unintended consequences.
Oh, okay, and finally, Convener, is this going to be a bigger issue as we move from, you know, 5-year LDP cycles to 10-year LDP cycles? You know, an almost 9-year-old document with sites that haven't come forward through that period, now with no safety release mechanism, is that going to cause a bigger problem?
Yes, I mean, the idea of the pipeline is that you've got your short-term, medium-term and long-term supply. So the long-term might be sites that currently have constraints that the local authority with the developers will work to address. Just now, the way the policy is worded, 16F, it has a safety valve for essentially local developments that, for affordable housing, which is fine, but obviously we need an all-tenure approach because as part of most all-tenure or as part of all developments, private ones are brought forward, there is a percentage affordable as well. So it's a need, and it's been touched upon earlier in the sessions as well, that we may need to look at how, is there a need for a safety valve in the next 5 years? Or equally, is it more putting the onus back on the planners to be able to plan, to make that balanced decision? And how many will go against MPF4? I'm not sure.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Gavin.
Okay, thanks, Mark. Pam, you have a supplementary.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Just last week, West Dunbartonshire Council became the fifth council to declare a housing emergency. Previously, Homes for Scotland highlighted that the NPF4 must be deliverable and be clear on how a deliverable land pipeline is to be identified and reviewed so that a consistent supply of homes is maintained over the long term. Do the panel think that the NPF4 puts the housing emergency at the heart of the planning system? So, over to you, Kevin.
They don't put it at the heart of the planning system at present. There is a need to elevate the housing need. It has to be obviously taken into consideration alongside all the other planning policies, but we do recognise, that not as an organisation, but I think as a country, that there is a housing need and an emergency just now, and it's how we address that. There's a lot of bits of work that Homes for Scotland are doing just now to try and help local authorities. It was touched upon by earlier on in the earlier session how local authorities are having to do a lot of extra tasks. You know, they've got 50 or just shy of 50 additional tasks, but their resources are dwindling. I know that Midlothian, when they did their last LDP, they had 8 planning officers, they've now got 5, and they've got all these additional tasks. So Homes for Scotland are trying to sort of pick up some of that slack, and we're producing guidance on housing land audits, site assessment methodologies and deliverability tests as well to try and help deliver a deliverable pipeline of homes so that we can have that system in place so we can deliver more homes for Scotland and up and down the country.
Kevin, it's good to hear that you're saying that you're actually stepping in, you know, the developers, obviously Homes Scotland as well, other people to help here, and local authorities have got less resources and obviously the shortages there. But what do you need from government? Obviously, you're here today in this committee. Where can we help? Because obviously, this is the fifth council to the housing, you know, emergency. And the fact that you've said today it doesn't, you know, help, with the NPF4, that the fact that to deliver that now and it doesn't take it into account, I think that's what you said. So where is it that the Scottish Government can help you, obviously, and we're here as a committee?
Sort of take part in short-term working groups to try and speed up the delivery of local development plans. So, as said, we don't want 34, we include national parks, different versions of different documents and resources taken up in those local authorities, for example, preparing them in the first place. We could have, you know, 5 public sector and 3 private sector people together in a room to create documents to try and accelerate sites being brought forward. We'll probably touch on resourcing later, but you know, just now there's reporters could potentially be getting used to look at site assessments for new sites for LDPs or helping with planning applications to try and build, bring those forward as well. These are things where there might be some need for government funding to help, potentially centralising, you know, producing the resource, or helping with the short-term working groups to free up resource at local authority level.
Come in.
If I may, yes, thank you. Just to unpick that, the issues around housing emergencies a little bit. The principal driver behind the declaration of housing emergencies is the situation that many councils are facing in the delivery of their homelessness services and their growing inability to meet their statutory obligations. So the 5 councils are all struggling every single day to meet statutory obligations around temporary accommodation, and that's what's driving the decisions around housing emergencies. Edinburgh, a good example, 1,500 individuals in temporary accommodation every single night. And what's causing that is straightforwardly a shortage of social housing. We have a chronic shortage of social housing across Scotland in our rural and our urban areas and our cities. And that is what is underpinning the fact that these councils, probably a third to a half of the sector now, not regularly and consistently in a position to meet its statutory obligations. So it's a shortage of social housing which is driving the housing emergencies. And you'll forgive me, there's no way of avoiding making the comment that that is only going to get worse in a world where those councils are now looking at resource planning assumptions for their affordable housing supply programme, which this year are between 26 and 27% lower than they were last year. Now, how we have come from a 16% reduction in the capital allocation by the Scottish Government to housing off the back of a 10% reduction in the capital allocation from the Westminster Government to the Scottish Government to a 26 or 27% reduction in the local resource planning assumptions, I'm not entirely clear, and obviously we're having that conversation with colleagues in the More Homes Division. But the programme's been cut by a quarter for the coming year, and there is no certainty about what the programme will look like next year. Now, these are long-term programmes. The work that is being done now will be about putting on-site developments for next year. But that work is going to have to get suspended or held back because you can't commit to a contract if you don't know what the resources are going to be. And many of these contracts span more than one financial year. So the position that we have with the Affordable Housing Supply Programme is absolutely critical. Our core problem, what drives housing emergencies, is a shortage of social housing that isn't necessarily directly addressed by NPF4. And the housing world or the housing system, the housing market has changed dramatically in the last 4 years. For a whole variety of reasons, which the folk who wrote NPF4 couldn't necessarily have been fully cited on. But we have an acute problem in the supply of social housing.
Thanks for that. Ilsa.
Agree with colleagues that it hasn't prioritised housing. And as Tony says, things are moving so quickly. So we do need flexibility in NPF4. And I think the proposal to bring forward things like master plan consent areas could be potentially quite helpful in some of these types of issues. I'll come back to some of the points we were making earlier around proportionality and being outcomes focused, that actually NPF4 could be made sufficiently flexible to help contribute to some of the outcomes that we need to see to address the housing crisis, which is, as Tony says, focused on homelessness, but then there's this broader issue about economic demand as well. So is how can we ensure that NPF4 is sufficiently flexible and that the people that are delivering NPF4 on the ground have the ability to take those risks and take that proportionate approach without fear of constantly being taken to appeal. So they need the cover. I would suggest that planning authorities need the cover from the Scottish Government to know that actually we need to be slightly more robust in our decision making and be more outcomes focused and not process focused. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much. Gordon, you've got a question.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Just to continue the conversations we've had already, before I ask my question, I'm keen to understand, Kevin, how much naturalisation contained in MPF4 is holding things back in terms of reusing brownfield land. Because if you look at the register of derelict and vacant land, much of it is previously used for housing, much of it has previously been used for hotels or hostel accommodation, for education facilities, for recreation, for retail, for office space, which could easily be used for housing. So, you know, of the over 3,000 sites in Scotland, what's actually stopping brownfield being used? I know some of it will be contaminated land from industrial use, but there's still a large proportion that was used for other purposes. And does MPF4 help or hinder moving forward?
So obviously the MPF4 does put a priority on development of brownfield land, but there is all those other things, some of them you just touched upon as well. So we have sites in east of Glasgow, for example, where housing was cleared because it was undermined, but it's now covered in water voles, which are protected, and it's very challenging to rehome them elsewhere in that area because it's not a suitable habitat. But you look at the other issues. I mean, obviously, a lot of our brownfield sites are around, you know, in town centres or in towns and villages are centred around watercourses predominantly when they're built up. So there's now CEPA's flooding maps have come in and they're looking at sort of the year 2100 when water levels will rise up and some of these brownfield sites are now at risk of flooding. And in terms of the application of policy there, it's very much, the computer says no. It's not allowing housing to come forward, even with pragmatic solutions. There's the undermining of coal, particularly through the west of Scotland, and all these issues add up to mean that a site's potentially not viable because a landowner will only sell their site once. So they're looking to get a certain land value, and it may not be in their interest to do so if all the abnormals associated with the housing development mean that they don't get the land value they're looking for.
Certainly, I mean, except some of what you've said, but some of the sites are flagged as development, short-term development, medium-term, which means that people think that they are viable sites. You mentioned the housing emergency that we're currently facing at the moment. Would it be more helpful, rather than continuing to build on good arable land in Scotland, would it be more helpful to try and bring it back into use, the 90,000 empty homes that we currently have in Scotland?
I think that's part of a bigger solution. I think this new house building has its place in terms of building forward new communities, helping support existing communities. But yes, bringing some of the existing vacant or empty houses forward is part of a bigger solution to solve the housing emergency.
Okay, thank you. Tony, I wanted to ask you about the number of council voids. You spoke about the housing emergency. There was an article in a newspaper recently which said there's over 10,000 council voids in Scotland. Is that correct?
I think the short answer to that is I don't know, because we won't get an accurate figure on the voids until this year's or last year's statistical returns are submitted. But what I can say is, looking at previous year's returns, is that probably 1,000 of those homes would have been identified as being for demolition, and a number of them won't be suitable for reletting. But more generally, it is the case that many local authorities and some housing associations are carrying more voids, operational voids, homes they want to get relet than they would want to, certainly more than they did in 2019 before the pandemic. We took a hit during the pandemic. It has been very difficult to recover from that. There is an enormous. We had a very detailed and focused conversation at our last Avacha meeting 2 weeks ago on this very subject, a deep dive, if you like. And what we heard was consistent efforts across the sector to recognise and to reduce the number of voids. Most councils reporting some success, but recognising that from a resource point of view, there are still voids coming in. So we're in a situation where we have to be resourced to process all those voids that are coming in new and then perform above our normal business as usual rate of void return and also return to use properties that are being purchased from the private sector on a second-hand basis to add to the stock. And it's a challenge. It will take time, but some authorities are saying we've reduced our voids by 25% this year. Others are saying we've struggled to make very much progress. There's a whole range of challenges in there. One of the most frequent over the last 5 years has been problems with electricity meters. One of the first things that happened at the start of the pandemic is that most of the electricity companies simply cancelled unilaterally the void supply contracts, which left councils with no way of actually putting power into a void once it was empty. And then huge problems in replacing meters, which are those meters that are either some of them damaged or clearing meters, so prepay meters that need to be cleared down. One authority tells me that they have three people full-time phoning utility companies to arrange to have meters removed, changed, repaired or cleared. I have heard stories of individuals spending 4 or 5 hours on the phone to arrange an appointment for that appointment, then not to be met by the utility company. So there are lots of practical problems in there, but there is a huge effort underway at the moment to reduce the number of voids. And we have another conversation this afternoon at COSLA on this very subject too. So it's a live issue. It is a problem. It's not the solution to our homelessness challenge. We have probably 30,000 households either in temporary accommodation or waiting for an offer of accommodation within the homelessness system at the moment. The voids will help. It isn't going to solve that problem. We have a shortage of social housing.
Also. Yeah, coming to the point of empty or underused homes, they can be a real blight, obviously, in a lot of rural and island communities, and MPF4 doesn't really address that. Mm. So Community Land Scotland did put forward a proposal that actually we should be looking at a different use class for houses that are not in permanent residential use, to enable local planning authorities and communities to actually identify houses that are underused in that regard, and look at different ways. And that could be through the planning system, it could be through the tax system. Obviously, there's a proposal for doubling council tax on second homes. But there's quite a lot of levers within that potentially could be within NPF4 and could be within Scottish Government's control that could address empty homes and actually bring some of these homes back into use. On Egg, we've got some people that are interested in selling their second homes to the community and other places as well. But we need a system of ensuring they stay as permanent residential homes, and there are opportunities through things like rural housing burden. So that's somewhere where the Scottish Government could really be very supportive in messaging that actually we can use our existing stock much better than we are doing at the moment.
And, you know, communities' concerns about second homes, I think there's about 24,000 second homes in Scotland, will be reflected in their local place plans.
Yes.
That they've created and about how to tackle them. So, I mean, have you got any experience of local place plans being developed in your community, and what impact have they had on planning decisions in your area?
Yes, we have actually, and coming back to the point about second homes and short-term lets, they're quite often quite high priority in local place plans, not in every community, but in those communities where they have a huge impact, which tend to be obviously rural and island communities. So they will quite often be a priority for action in those local place plans. And what we have found is that local planners have actually been quite instrumental in suggesting to communities, here's a really good approach, why don't you try a local place plan, we will help you. Quite often they don't come with funding, which is a problem, and we know local place plans can cost from 2,000 to 100,000, depending on what you're looking at. But I think lots of local planning authorities have seen local place plans as a good way of addressing what communities want to see in their local development plan, because it's very much a bottom-up approach. And then that has started to identify projects for action. So coming back to some of the points that were made earlier, plans are good in themselves, obviously, but it's actually what you deliver out of them that are the really, really important outcomes. So I would say a community close to me, Isle of Ling, the local planning authority, Argyll and Bute Council, suggested that they develop a local place plan. They got funding to do that. They brought in a firm of architects who did fantastic consultation with the community, and that's now started to bring projects forward, which the planners are obviously supportive of, because although they weren't terribly involved in the development of the plan, they are going to adopt it as part of the LDP. So the process is actually really good. The issues are whether or not the community's got the capacity to do it, and you'll always find some communities that have got the planners and the lawyers lawyers and the accountants and communities that don't. So it's an issue of equity and then an issue of cost, and then an issue making sure that the local planning authority have got the resources to at least be able to contribute to the process and not be presented with a document at the end of the process where they say, well, we can't do any of that.
Okay. Tony, what's your experience of local place plans?
In short, in recent experience, very little. My apologies. I'm aware that they are a feature of the new planning system in MPF4 and indeed the planning legislation itself. I think that's a very powerful addition to it. I think it allows and I have been involved in those types of processes in the past, but not in terms of this planning regime. I think they're important in allowing an opportunity to have an open discussion about the types of pressures that communities see and their concerns about new housing. And there remains a problem with some communities who are concerned about the impact of new housing. I have had some quite difficult conversations in public meetings with communities who are concerned about the impact of council housing in their communities, because even where council housing already exists. And those types of processes allow an opportunity to unpick those concerns and understand them better, and then hopefully answer them and ensure that what's delivered actually meets local needs. But I can't claim to have any immediate experience of the process of developing at the moment.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you.
Okay. Kevin, you want to come in on that, and maybe Donna as well?
Sorry, just to say that my experience is predominantly local place plans tend to be reactive, so the local community maybe aren't supportive of a planning proposal, whether through a local development plan or a planning application, and then produce their local place plan afterwards. I think there very much needs to be a proactive engagement between the local community and developers to perhaps identify shared goals, ultimately, if they're wanting housing in their area, to bring proposals forward together.
Donna, did you have anything to add on local place plans?
Yeah, just to reiterate what's already been said, I think local place plans have the opportunity to really empower communities, but also build that partnership and collaboration between local authorities and communities, which in some rural island communities, it's not a great relationship or hasn't been in the past. I think Argyll and Bute Council have been doing some fantastic work and have really great examples of how they have really empowered their communities by listening and supporting them and encouraging, and that obviously has a knock-on, well, a positive effect on community-led housing delivery, which Scottish Government is relying on communities to come forward and provide a lot of the housing. What Tony had previously mentioned about social housing, I think there is a huge, particularly with local place plans, there with local authorities, there's a huge expectation on them in terms of social housing, and the Scottish Government looking at community-led delivery. Local place plans are a great way to actually bring together the local authority and the communities to ensure that the needs are met, but it's realistic goals as well. But they need to be rural-proofed, used effectively as a tool, and funding, as Ailsa had mentioned, is a key one. Many community groups just simply don't have that funding and that key skill set as well to be able to produce such documents. So they are relying on externals to come in, but they don't have the money to do that. So it feels that MPF4 definitely looks, you know, it talks about rural housing and delivery, but how is that delivery actually going to happen, and how is that support going to be put in place, particularly for communities?
Okay, great. Thanks very much for that. Just, I meant to ask this earlier, Donna, so it's not so much about local place plans, but in terms of the funding part, do you think that the Rural and Island Housing Fund needs to be more flexible? That's to use Ronnie McRae's term he used last week, more flexible in acknowledging all of the different requirements for pieces of work that need to go together, like the BAT report and all of those kinds of things. Do you think that the funding needs to acknowledge that better?
Absolutely. I think the feasibility funding element isn't enough. And it's been highlighted by communities. And what they end up doing is, and which we provide a lot of support for, is scrambling around to find pots of cash that they can add up the money to be able to pull together all the necessary information and documents and surveys that they require. There doesn't seem to be that one element of support funding that supports all of that and actually encourages communities to continue this. And a lot of them just give up because it's too much in terms of skills, in terms of costs. So I definitely think that there's huge room for improvement there. And I think support, it's brilliant to see that Scottish Government are encouraging communities, but I definitely feel that that support system has to be put in place.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. Now I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us here and online. In the previous panel, asked a question with regards to some of the concerns which have been put to us around wording of some of the policies in MPF 4 and these being unclear and leading to inconsistent decision making. And we have heard evidence around evidence reports and how different councils are looking at that guidance not being in place as well. So just wondered what your experience has been of that and what solutions do you think could be taken forward to have that more consistent approach? Does anyone want to come in here or online on that?
I'll start. Across the country, there's been different approaches to take things forward. Biodiversity, for example, we've got local guidance just now that came out last year and still says draft on it. We've got a consultation being run just now by Nature Scott over a four-week period into a first phase of looking at a metric that's going to be brought in. So whilst it's important to get that right and learn from experiences in other parts of the UK, there's a lot of clarity still needed to be sort of brought into the next level, so be just below MPF4, whether that be the biodiversity net gain or perhaps local living, as we've touched upon earlier, and flooding as well. So SEPA have produced about three different bits of guidance. I think they've still got a few more to produce below that as well. So there's just that uncertainty and need for clarity just now. And I think, as we said earlier, keen to help, take part in the working groups, etc., but to help accelerate these things, because we're a year on from MPF4 and local development plans are a couple of years away, so we need more clarity to be able to make decisions now to deliver more homes.
I wouldn't really have much to contribute to what my colleague said earlier, but I think there is this issue, isn't there, about consistency, and Donna and I are talking about, yes, but you need local flexibility. And the situation is dynamic, it is changing, so I think, yes, consistency would be great, but it's not always possible, and I think we need to be realistic about the fact it's not always possible, and that we do need that local guidance, so I think there's a real balance here, and we probably haven't got to that balance yet, but it's not as straightforward as just having a blanket consistent policy across the whole of Scotland, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, if I may, thank you. I think there's a couple of observations that are worth making around the question of consistency. The first one is that it's one person's postcode lottery is another person's democratic outcome. Local authorities do have to have the ability to interpret and make decisions based on their local community's needs and their local situation. We need to be not too obsessed about consistency. I think there are one or two areas where the wording hasn't produced what we hoped it would produce. So if you look at Policy 16 around housing, I think there was an expectation in the way that's worded that all developments would have to have at least 25% of affordable or social housing in them, and that hasn't been how it's turned out, and there have been quite substantial developments approved without any affordable housing at all. And one that springs to mind in a community not far from where I am, 1,000 homes approved on appeal by the reporter with no affordable or social housing. Because in the reporter's view, there was no demonstrated need, which is in the next sentence in that paragraph. I'm not sure if those two sentences connect up in quite the way the reporter thought they did. But the bottom line is 1,000 homes were approved and there will be no social or affordable housing in any part of that development. I struggle to understand how that is a balanced or sustainable community that's being developed there. And I think that's problematic. So I think we do need to be a bit clearer about that. And I think we need to be more confident in being clear that these outcomes need to be public policy-led. One of the problems in our planning system, which I think a developer colleague quite rightly are concerned about, is it isn't very predictable. It isn't very predictable. The Section 75 negotiation process, for example, will on occasion involve a degree of gaming of the system, which is an entirely legitimate thing to do given the way it works. And it would be helpful if we could remove some of that uncertainty. I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. No, that's helpful and leads on actually quite well to my next question. with regards to infrastructure first, and I wanted to ask around that whether or not there has been a different approach. We touched upon some of the Section 75 potential reforms, but you know, for me as a Lothian MSP, I think that sort of regional growth we've seen around house building hasn't then necessarily matched the infrastructure which is needed. There's predictions of around 80% of all future growth being here in Edinburgh and the southeast of Scotland. And so making sure we actually have that infrastructure first approach is something I think we need to see. And so how do you think MPF4 is helping to facilitate that? And if it's not, how can it be tweaked to try to make sure that the services we're all going to rely on are actually going to be there, especially where we've seen significant developments in peripheral areas of the capital, for example? I don't know if you want to come in, Tony, on that, and then anyone else.
It's not, others will know more. I think when we think about infrastructure, we tend to think about roads, for example, or water and drainage. We also need to, and then after that, perhaps social infrastructure, schools, health services and the like. One of the major constraints that we are starting to face, particularly given the way in which the building standards have gone, is around the grid, the electricity supplies. In moving from essentially a predominantly gas-based domestic heating to effectively 100% electric heating, we're moving into a position where the current grid is simply incapable of sustaining that level of demand, and there isn't the investment going in to address that. So I think we have the document acknowledges infrastructure first as the appropriate way to go. I think that's important, but the trick is going to be to tie up those investment programs in a way that that works effectively, and that does mean it has to be a planned-led approach, because you won't persuade these utility providers to invest or the network providers to invest heavily if there isn't some certainty about growing demand in those areas. So it does mean a bit more discipline in the way in which larger schemes in particular are brought forward, approved, developed, and then built. And I made a point earlier on about 9,000-10,000 homes a year being consented in the system which have not then been constructed. In terms of current needs, that's 50,000 or 60,000 planning approvals that haven't been actioned, significantly more than the number of empty homes, for example, in the council sector. So there is, it's a critical part of the approach, but we need to be aware of all the elements of infrastructure we play in.
Yeah. Does anyone else anything else to add?
I think just in terms of infrastructure first, it's obviously, as you say, very important to have the infrastructure that supports the new homes, the new residents, and indeed the existing residents. With an MPF4, something that's new is the six tests that have to be met for any developer contribution. So house builders, when they do develop a site, may end up paying a contribution towards transport infrastructure, education, health, etc. So, but these are things that, obviously, if you think about even the cost of putting a planning application in, can't be paid for up front. Looking at an example in just outside Ayr, there's millions of pounds required up front before a developer can even put a spade in the ground. That's not the sort of money a developer has when they're putting all the other infrastructure in. So there is a need for mechanisms to perhaps front fund that and recoup the funding through the Section 75 payment. But it's also important to realise that there has been cases up and down the country where developer contributions have been taken to fund infrastructure that then hasn't been delivered. I'm aware of cases in Aberdeenshire where healthcare infrastructure contributions were sought, and that nothing was implemented, so that the money was then returned to the developer. So it has to be the right infrastructure that is actually, you know, tried, tested, and reasonable to be delivered.
Yeah. I would just say a lot of the barriers to development, certainly in the community sector, around the infrastructure that Tony talks about, so power and water in particular, and that's completely out with the influence of MPF4. Sure. So I think planning policy, you know, it could help provide that certainty for development in large scales, but in small scale sites, you know, the planners, I'm sure, are really keen to approve and do approve, but then developments don't proceed because of those infrastructure barriers.
Yeah, thank you. And I just wanted to ask a question that follows on from Gordon MacDonald's line of question earlier around town centre regeneration. And, you know, here in Edinburgh, we're seeing a lot of former office sites, for example, change of purpose to housing. Or other sites which have become student housing, for example. But just wondered, and I know from colleagues across Parliament, in more rural areas who have really seen their high street completely disappear, where MPF4, and it, in the last year, doesn't seem to have facilitated any real change, could actually help potentially look towards housing being part of that, and what different model needs to be provided to make that stack up financially for developers to potentially look at town centre regeneration a completely different way and facilitate that. And just wondered if you had any views on what currently isn't in MPF4 which could help actually shape that.
The idea of the master plan consent areas is quite a good one for town centre living. If there was a presumption that sort of, properties above shops could be immediately returned to residential, and again thinking about some of these broad, it depends what do we want to prioritise it. We talked earlier on about the housing emergency. We've also got a climate emergency. We've got a funding emergency. We've got a biodiversity emergency. We've got loads of emergencies. What takes priority? And I think in things like town centre living, there are opportunities under MPF4 and the proposals for the master plan consent areas to actually enable more private sector development. And again, it's taking that sort of outcomes approach. What are we trying to achieve here, and what's the best route to getting it?
Just coming as well. So a lot of regeneration and brownfield and windfall sites delivered in town centres and villages is by SMEs. So pre-recession, 40% of all house completions were delivered by SMEs. Homes for Scotland have just done some research, and I'm about to give you some headlines before we've published it, but it's now down at 15%. Because a lot of them aren't there anymore. You know, it's not worth them continuing. So I think there's maybe a need for a more proportionate approach for smaller sites in terms of how they can be brought forward and what hoops they've got to jump through. I touched upon earlier by one of the other panel members about the number of conditions, the way you can maybe look at a decision, what can you maybe defer till a later date so that the smaller developers can get funding up front to actually get on site and then or get further along to then get the funding for the last bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Does Donna or Tony have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I suppose one of the issues to be aware of is the extent to which our town centres are resident friendly, the way in which they operate. So it's all very well saying, yes, we could make these areas above shops work as housing, but people need to want to live in those houses, and which means what goes on around them. The other uses, whether it's fast food or it's pubs or it's the nighttime economy, need to be appropriate, and there needs to be a demand from people that want to live in central urban areas as well. So in larger cities, absolutely, there's no reason why you shouldn't be able to develop a great deal of the vacant space in on the upper floors. But in other communities where that isn't the aspiration of families in particular, or where it's difficult to provide the types of facilities that a family would need in that location, I think we need to have a think about how that would work. That said, I can think of two city centre developments on brownfield sites, not far from where I'm sitting. Large-scale developments, relatively speaking, 50-odd homes in one development, one for older people, one for mid-market rent, both of which there was some doubt about whether or not there would be demand, and there absolutely was a significant number of people who wanted to live at that location and in those homes, albeit that there were four- and five-storey buildings and in a central urban area. So it's, I think particularly the social housing sector is nervous of those types of developments and can sometimes be a bit braver, I would say.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks. I just want to mention, Miles, you might be interested in recent work that was led by the Scottish Town Centre Partnership, Scottish Land Commission, Architectural and Design Scotland and Scottish Futures Forum, all about town centre living, and might be something that we want to dip into, because I think they've uncovered some very useful information and have recently reported to the Scottish Government and COSLA on that. So there's something there for us to pick up. I wanted just to say that Stephanie Callaghan had to leave, so she sends her apologies, and I'm going to pick up her two questions that she wanted to ask. So in a way, this one's a bit connected to town centre living, but MPF4 seeks to deliver both compact urban growth and development that is balanced between areas of high and low demand. And I'd be interested to understand from your perspective, Kevin, what are the builders doing to support the delivery of these aims? And then Tony, in terms of local authorities, and Donna, and then Ailsa, in terms of community groups. So
yeah, ultimately, land is a very precious resource, so developers will ultimately look to maximise what they can get out of a site, but that's obviously not at expense of place. There are things, however, that go counter to that. For example, the parking requirements, for example, on a site, if you look at a three-bed house or flat, you need three parking spaces. So these are very land-hungry when we're looking to move away from, you know, cars to ultimately active travel. So it's just trying to get the right balance, to get the right density for sites, to make it ultimately viable for the development, deliver the new homes that are needed.
Okay, that's a great example about the continued parking issue. But Tony, I'm going to come to you on local authorities. How are they managing to do this balance?
The councils will look positively on developments that contribute to place and bring people into a central urban area. There's no question about that. But it has to work. It has to be a place where folk want to live. Now, some of that is about understanding what people are looking for. Some of it is also about recognising that it costs a great deal of money. It costs more to develop on a brownfield site or in a central urban area than it does on a nice, flat, connected greenfield site. And we are already in a world where councils are talking about £300,000 to build a council flat. We are in some places spending more to build council homes than you could sell them for, and that's to do with partly to do with the quality, but it's also to do with the whole range of other costs that now go with building homes. So there's always a balance there in terms of how you get best value for the money that you're spending. But I think some of it is that we have in part lost the habit of inner urban living. We need to relearn that. We need to make our inner urban spaces attractive for families as places to live as well as places to visit. And we could probably learn a great deal from our European neighbours around how you do that, how you create child-friendly spaces in town centres. And there are plenty of good examples in Europe. We also need to get, if we're going to develop car-free developments, then you absolutely have to have the public transport available to make that viable for families and for individuals. And we're a long way short of that.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, I think that's a certainly good point about needing to relearn the urban living. Now, I do think there are great examples. So Moray Council certainly is leading on a very good example in Elgin around a bit of town centre regeneration, which is going to be mixed use. And then we have a fantastic example in Dumfries where that's been community-led mixed-use housing with mid-steeple quarter. But Donna, what are your thoughts on this balance?
Yeah, and not so many examples of kind of town centre living, rural urban, we would call it. But there's an interesting point to make about areas of regeneration. So there's quite a few rural and island communities that are looking at areas that were probably, in terms of an island life in particular, was probably classed as the town living, the town centre of the island. Those areas have depopulated massively. Housing has so much gone into disrepair and derelict. But looking at what kind of the regeneration and what housing projects can be brought, there is a housing project on the horizon, hopefully, in one particular area. But cost-wise, for a community to do this, I mean, the groundworks alone are £500,000 for this project. But also, in terms of planning and NPF4, there are many barriers in the way of innovative kind of housing, sustainable community living, whereby cars, you know, aren't going through the houses. It's very much a sense of co-sharing, co-housing spaces, safe, green, encouraging cycling, encouraging walking. But when it gets to the planning stage, unfortunately, it's come back with, well, you need a two-way road through those houses because you might have a bin lorry and a fire engine turn up at the same time. Chances are in these communities is that the driver of the bin lorry is the driver of the fire engine. So really it's looking at how do you mould to suit that actual area. Creating a housing development in this particular area that I'm talking about would revitalise that place completely and bring a whole sense of life. But it would encourage families to live in somewhere where they probably wouldn't live previously. So it does link slightly to that kind of town centre on a real kind of remote rural kind of sense. But it would massively increase the footfall within that area in a healthy, positive way. Unfortunately, current planning is standing in the way of that.
Thanks. Ilse, do you have anything to add?
A lot of the sites that we're talking about here, particularly in town centres, the private sector's not intervening because the profit's not there. We all understand that. So it's very much dependent on bringing these sites forward. It's going to be dependent on a mix of an enabling planning regime under MPF4, and potentially it's not yet enabling enough, having the right sort of funding regime from Scottish Government, and we know that some of those funds have been cut recently for reasons we all understand, and issues over land ownership and asset ownership. And again, until we've got sort of the land reform agenda that actually addresses urban issues as well and enables these sites to the owner to be identified and a route forward to be acquired and then developed. There's a lot of blockers in the way of a lot of this urban regeneration that we're talking about, and NPF4 is part of it, but it's only a small part of it.
Okay, I've got another question around the place principle, which in a way, Donna, you've already touched on with your example there of the two-way street needing to be put in place and then actually not really suiting the community. But I'd be interested to hear from others, to what extent do you think the place principle, which underpins NPF4 delivery plan, guides the action, actually guides the actions of planning departments, developers and others, and what could be done to further embed this principle in decision making? Kevin.
So from my experience, I did work for a PLC house builder, where you would go and have pre-application discussions, you'd be looking at a design street solution. Some councils welcomed that, others welcomed it in principle, however knew that the roads colleagues wouldn't support it. So we did have occasions where we'd take an example through planning committee, and it would be a design street solution. Then you get to the RCC, the road construction consent stage, and be told that that's not what we support. We want 5 metre wide road, 2 metre wide footpath either side, which just changes the whole dynamic of the development from something that's very much, you know, balance of people and cars movement through the sites to car and vehicle dominated, whether it be the fire engine or the refuse vehicle. So there is a need for not so much education, but more of a reflection through other consultees in the planning process in terms of how they engage to deliver place.
That's great. That's a very good point. Anybody else on how the place principles are being delivered? Tony?
Just really an observation about those types of issues. So the width of pavement, width of roads, street lighting is another issue. I had debates with the rural communities when I worked in housing about, well, we don't have street lights in the rest of the village, why do we need them here? There are good reasons why these principles are in place around place. So if you're looking at, we're not just designing for the likes of us. So width of pavements, width of roads, street lighting bear on community safety, they bear on access to people with disabilities, wheelchair users, people with the limited sight. And it's so you need to think about this in a slightly broader frame than just, well, I could walk in a metre wide pavement, what's the problem? It's not just about you. Can we think about it in a slightly wider terms? That doesn't mean there isn't scope for flexibility, but let's not miss the equality, the accessibility and the human rights agenda that is attached to some of these concerns.
I think thanks so much for bringing up that point. Yes, definitely need to be looking at it in a wider scope. Pam, you have a question.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, we have touched upon it that the planning budget has been cut by 43% by the Scottish Government. So I wanted to ask the question, it might be one for you, Tony, that are planning departments still facing resource shortages and that hinder their ability to effectively oversee development planning and management systems? And if so, what level of confidence do you have in the proposed changes to the planning fee system to address this issue?
I confess I was really hoping that this question would get asked in the first session and I wouldn't have to deal with it because it's not an area that I'm particularly strong. First of all, my understanding is the reduction in the planning budget is a central budget and it's around the development of online planning services rather than the delivery of local planning services. Now, I could be wrong, but that's my understanding. But planning services, I think it's already been mentioned, like all other services, have faced significant resource reductions over recent years. And the issue of planning fees and whether or not the planning system should be self-funding in that sense, I think, remains to be resolved. I think it would probably make sense to have a clear statement of principle around how the planning system should be funded and where those burdens should fall, and then a degree of certainty that planning fees will be applied in the appropriate way. I have to confess, this is one of the areas where we... My apologies,
Sorry, I'm going to have to leave. Sorry.
I'll continue if that's okay. One of the areas where we occasionally disagree with colleagues in COSLA, who are very firm in their view that funding a local authority should not be ring-fenced and councils should have the ability to spend the income that they have in the way that they see fit. I think there is a case in some areas for a very clear and quite strict homologation of income, and planning fees might be one of those, so that developers have the confidence that what they're paying for is what they're getting. But if they're paying for a service, but if they're getting the service, they also need to pay for it. So, and that might bear down on other considerations about the way the planning system operates and who pays for what. But I think we are in a place where these services are under-resourced. There were comments made this morning about a lack of planners, about a lack of trainee planners, the difficulty in recruiting planners. If you want the system to operate in a particular way, you have to resource it to achieve that.
Great, thanks. Has anyone got anything to add to that? Kevin.
From a house builder perspective, we would advocate ring fencing of planning fees to help support delivery of development management function. It's something I think that came up in out of the Competition Market Authority report as well, that need to help resource that system. If the Scottish Government are obviously looking at different ways that the system can be funded and delivered through their existing or their current consultation, and we've touched upon ways that Homes for Scotland would be willing to take part and assist in picking up some of the slack, but ultimately if the system can't deliver, we can't really be putting the fees up further because we're not getting the quality back. That's a concern from house builders, is that we're going to be asked to pay more. We were asked to pay more 3 years ago, we were asked to pay more 2 years before that, and the system and the service hasn't unfortunately improved in that time. And it was touched upon earlier about digital interventions. I think there's a huge opportunity, and it's disappointing that the funding's been cut for that, and they're looking to start the funding again, but there might be digital solutions, whether it be looking at permitted development rights and you're getting answers to whether or not you need permission, or looking at a validation system that's digitised for planning applications, that, you know, simple examples of how to free up planner time and resource.
Okay, great. I'm going to move on to the final question, which I asked in the previous panel as well. So the Scottish Government last week proposed a new set of national outcomes, including a new outcome for housing, which is we live in safe, high quality and affordable homes that meet our needs. And panellists in the earlier session, but I think also here we've talked about it a bit too, have spoken about the difficulties of aligning various national policies. Could a new overarching national outcome on housing help with that alignment? And to what extent does the delivery of NPF4 already connect with the existing national outcomes, for example, on communities and environment? Any thoughts on that? Do we need a new outcome for housing specifically?
I think it would be helpful, given the fact we have 5 housing emergencies and probably more to be declared. So there's nothing to be lost by it. But as we've already said, I think that the policies are all fine. It's the implementation and the gaps in the implementation that are the issue. And I think they've been fairly well detailed today, where we all know we need more housing. And we need more new housing. We need our existing housing stock to be better used. And how we're going to achieve that is not easy, it's not straightforward, but we do have the levers available to us.
Yeah, I'd second that, and I think it's something that Craig touched on earlier, like PIPAG or Housing to 2040 strategy, need to sort of pick up in terms of how we can take this forward and knit it all together.
Great. Anybody online want to come in on that? Donna, you've indicated. I'm sorry, Tony.
Yeah, not surprisingly, we are also in favour of a national outcome for housing. But the one word of caution I would offer up, though, is that it needs to be measurable and it needs to be measured. Now, our own work suggests that significant numbers of households in Scotland do not live in safe, high-quality homes that meet their needs. We would suggest at least 500,000 households. Colleagues in Homes for Scotland have suggested a higher figure. It needs to be measurable. We need to measure it. Our data, which is not currently as good as it needs to be substantially improved if we're going to do that. And then we need to track it, and we need to be accountable for improvements or declines in it as well. So it's a bit like the human rights outcome that we have within the framework at the moment. Yeah, fine. Although it is no more than a statement of the international treaty obligations, there's no metrics against it. It's never been measured. Mm. We have no idea. And it's the same with housing. If we're going to have a housing outcome, then we need to agree what the measures are, we need to measure it, and we need to report it as well so we can see whether we're making progress.
Thanks for that. I mean, I think that we took some... We're doing a piece of work around building quality and safety, I think it is. So it's interesting to hear you're saying 500,000 people are not living in the appropriate housing, and we're looking at, you know, some of the issues there of what's going on in people's housing. And something that's come up quite frequently is the idea of some kind of database or tracking of how what's going on in housing and what it's made of, even, you know, with the issues of cladding and rack that's come forward now. How do we start to actually look at those things as well?
I was aware of a conversation around trying to develop a database of the construction details of Scotland's buildings. That's a huge, huge task. I wouldn't start being as ambitious as that. I think it would be helpful just to define what we mean by adequate housing in broad terms, and then put a metric against each of the key elements. I would say that the two areas where we found the most shortfall was in affordability and accessibility and adaptations. We have very large numbers of households with disabilities who can't access every room in their house, and we have very, very large numbers of people who struggle day to day to afford the home that they're living in.
Okay, great. Thanks so much for that. I think that's brought us to the end of our questions, and once again, another really useful panel to hear from. It's been good to hear from you all on your perspectives on the National Planning Framework 4. And I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover, or to allow for witnesses to leave, actually. Thanks very much. The next item on our agenda this morning is to consider the following negative instrument: Town and Country Planning General Permitted Development Scotland Amendment Order 2024. And there's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do members have any comments on the instrument? Miles.
I think in terms of the committee's consideration, I would like to see some further information about the areas this will cover and the scope of this instrument, which if we had time to do that, whether or not inviting the minister or writing to them would be useful.
Okay. I think that's... So we'll take that away and look at that. And we previously agreed to take the next three items in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.